Dubstep.
What's happening? This is Skream and you're watching Dubfiles. I got into making dubstep when I was about 14, just from basically the underground garage sort of scene, like the LBs, the Wookiees, artwork, sound mentor, all them sort of people, and basically just started going in Big Apple Records because my brother Hijack used to work there. Like, met Hatcha, he was playing this sort of underground sort of sound, and I just got in on it from there. Really, was going Velvet Rooms from like the age of 14, just building beats and getting them played at Forward. Dubstep's whatever you want it to be, man. There's no, I don't like defining it because it's something different for everyone else. For some people, it's somewhere to get away on their own and just chill out without having their face watched. For me, it's just about beats, bass and energy, really. Do you know what I mean? Skream the producer always comes first because it's my livelihood. It's got me to the places to play. Like, I always wanted to DJ when I was younger, but then it gets a bit, you feel like you're never going to make it because what have you got to offer? That at the time, for me, it was like, with DJs like EZ and all people like that, you could never have got into the garage scene, so you got to start writing your beats, get looked at as a producer, and then they want you to come and play your music, innit? A DJ definitely pushes the sound, because you're going out and I'm playing 80% of my own tunes, and I've got the bangers from everyone else, so I'm playing sort of some of the best tunes from the scene, and I'm showing people some of the best tunes from a new type of music. Sonar Festival a couple of weeks ago was probably the best highlight because there was 8,000 people there, do you know what I mean? Just having it to dubstep music and just seeing something completely amazing and seeing something that you've sort of grown up pushing and believing in, sort of answer everyone's stupid questions of where the music's going. I was listening back to some tracks I'd done in 2003, and it's like, some of the stuff was original for the time, do you know what I mean? And it was like, now some of the stuff I sort of know what I'm going to build. Not all the time, but if I'm going around to do a certain type of track, I know, bang, I can use that noise, then I use this noise, put them together, and it's going to be all right. But before it was like, I'd just done what I wanted, because I had no one else to work off, and it was just like, there weren't really much of a scene. There was a few guys doing stuff, so then, but the sound's changed, the production's got a lot better, like mixed down engineering side of things. It's just got a lot more, at the moment, a lot more energy, more dance floor, more sort of, it's the DJing thing, do you know what I mean? It's obvious because now I've got to make people dance when they go out and play, so I'm making more dance floor sort of stuff. But I've got some alternative sort of shit, like some deep bass line, just subbed out things. But no, a bit different stuff at the minute, to be honest. The Judgment was really just a tune me and Benga done. It was just one of many that we'd done at the time, but it was just one that got a lot more attention and a lot more, just caused a lot more of a stir, because we was 14 and he was 13, I think, or it was around 15, 16, and it was like, the big boys weren't making tunes like this, and they had £1,000 studios, whereas we just had PCs and samples, do you know what I mean? So it was, the tune done us really good. It got us a lot of attention early, which I believe, because of that track, we're still getting attention now. It sort of kept our name at the top of a scene that wasn't really doing much for a little while. And then by the time it did start moving, we were still sort of at the top of the game. I made Request Line, basically, just for being bored of turkey sandwiches. I'd had enough of the festive season. I just wanted to get back on writing some beats. And I just sat down. And to be honest, it started out as a grime tune. But then I thought, why do I want to do a grime tune? I don't make grime. And then I just sort of put all mine into it. And that was the sort of bass, and I mucked about the arpeggiators and stuff. And it just sort of come from there, bro. It didn't blow up. The tune didn't blow for a year and a half till after I made it, do you know what I mean? It was a weird one, because it was by the time that blew, I had so much new stuff, and stuff that was banging. And that was getting the attention, so it was what, do I go back a few steps? Or do I just carry on doing what I do? So I just carried on doing what I was doing, man, still am now. Making tunes like Summer Dreams, it was for me, it was, I'm going back into my past of where I've grown up listening to tunes. I was a garage boy, standard, that was the music of my generation, like, of my age group, that was always was. And but I always got into the more dark, jazzy, Zed Bias, Mad Slinky, futuristics type things, and for me that's the sort of stuff they'd done, and it was like, I feel that I got to a stage where I could sort of, I could build tunes like that. Not maybe not as great as they did, but I've got to a stage where I know what I want to get down, so them tunes, if I wanted to do it, so I just sort of done it. And then we worked with the trumpet player and everything, and it just sort of all come together like beautifully. It's still one of my favourite tunes I've done. I love it, man. I suppose it's what happens after you have a big tune. You get all these sort of opportunities and you get people, oh yeah, yeah, come do a remix for me. Especially as the music's growing as a whole as well. I'm in a comfortable position, so it's, I get treated comfortably almost. Like I can get, it's easier for me to get remix parts than it is for other people. If I like, if I want to do a mix, not saying any track, but there's, I've probably got a lot more chance of being able to do it and get it done official than someone who's never been heard of, do you know what I mean? It's just I enjoy the remixing, it gets me out of like lulls of like writer's block, and sometimes when I just get a bit stuck, it's like, right, I'll go them parts, bang, 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 and just recreate your own tune, man. Me and Tempo I've been going forward for years, and as you know, Sarah runs Tempo, runs forward, and it was just sort of waiting to happen. I always worked for Big Apple, and then with the shop shutting down and the label going quiet for a long time, it was just the next move. It was, who else was, there ain't really no one else worth going to other than Tempo, because I've been pushing it from day, and it's like, it's a good relationship, man. I enjoy working with Tempo because they're professional and good, man. They know how to run things, man. Yeah, my first release is coming on my label, Disfigured Dubs. It's a track I've done with Clue Kid called Sand Snake, and the beat and the AA side is Moving Snares, which is by myself, which is like a teched out roller. But yeah, make sure you get and buy it. New York was amazing. I appreciate the way people around the world treat me rather than the music as a whole. I get treated good when I go away. And it's nice to be able to go like so far away and get treated like you're still at home. But people are excited about dubstep, everyone's into it. I haven't played at a party for probably over a year where it hasn't been having it. It hasn't been rocking. Like every party I go to now, they're just having it, man. And I love playing abroad, and it sometimes pisses me off when you come back to London and you see some of the way just crowds in certain places are changing, and just the whole attitude towards music in London, we're too greedy, man. Like a lot of people around the world ain't got as much access to music as we have. And it's like people just need to appreciate it more rather than people who go out and fight and shit. Either go out and listen to music or stay at home. It's not just stellar, man. I like a beer, do you know what I mean? To be honest, I think it's probably in my head, but I think I DJ better on after a few cans. Like, nah, it's just, do you know what? The whole Stella Session thing on the Rinse show, it come around from, it was a joke one night. I had a bag of Stellas, it was like my first show, and I was like, ah, oh, it's a Stella Session. And then it just, every week I got Stellas, and it was like, it's the Stella Session. But yeah, I've had a couple of Evian sessions, just water. Like last week, I was a bit broke. I was just bang on the waters. Everyone's got their own view, man. I just personally think it's, I think it's because I make music. Like, I think it affects final sales, like playing CDs. It don't sound the same at all. And I just think dubs, people want to see a DJ play vinyl or dubs. Just, I think it's just that DJ thing. So they can see what you're playing. I think that's it. When someone's playing a CD, it don't look as exciting. I don't know, that probably doesn't make sense. I'm just not really in it. Like, the thing is, if someone like me, I should really be playing, because I've got so much stuff. If I played CDs, I could play a lot more tunes. But it's just, the sound, it just ain't there. The bottom end ain't there, and the top end's there too much. It just, I don't know, it just don't sound right in clubs. I think music on a whole is the internet's help, because it's like, you can now discuss a tune with someone fucking sitting in the North Pole. You can talk your views on a tune, or you can play someone your music like that. Bro, you can send an email in seconds. You can bang your tune in there. It's massively important. At the same time, it ruins it, because the whole Napster fucking... Bro, my album ended up on there before it even hit the shops. And it's like, why, man? And like them Russian sites, mate. Russian sites are bootlegging the tunes, man. I've got a little keyboard and a PC, man. I use FL Studio, and I just use loads of plugins. I'm not going into which plugins. I ain't got a good set of monitors, man. Sweater, I've got a standard pair of old Tannoys, but it's just I've had them so long, I might be a bit of an exception because I know the speakers, but I'm getting a new pair of dying audios and like getting Logic and shit. But it's just I'm waiting for the older. I'm listening to a lot of new rave sort of indie music at the moment, to be fair. There's a lot of good bands in England, I think, but they're just like Arctic Monkeys, man. They're tearing up the scene, I think. Like Klaxons, there's a lot of bands. I think it's you sort of growing up, you tend to fight against that music when you're living in sort of an urban culture. Do you know what I mean? It's like it's for the Devon boys or whatever. I don't know, like. But it's, yeah, I've been listening to like a lot of techno, a lot of house. I've been making some house. And yeah, I'm feeling that there's loads of producers at the minute. There's like Mala from Digital Mystics, obviously. All them boys, like Koki's smashing, like genius. Benga's working on his new album, which is going to be massive. Burial, Code 9, everyone, bro. Everyone in the scene at the minute, I'm feeling. There's a lot of good music coming from Dubstep at the moment. Just look at my MySpace and, yeah, I'm about, just come and check me in your local town, innit? You can hear me playing every Wednesday night, 9 to 11 Grand Meridian time on www.rinse.fm, the home of underground music. Yeah, that's the main place you can listen to my music at www.myspace.com/ScreamUK, all one word. And then you can catch me playing places like Forward at Plastic People, Shoreditch, DMZ at Brixton Mass. Yeah, just all over the show, man. No, I'm making music for St. Giles. I can't really ever see another me doing anything else, like from now till I'm in a box, to be honest. You couldn't get me in an office because I can't stand discipline. I couldn't work in those shops or nothing, so I can't be told what to do, man. I used to play football, but music, I just got into music and got into the non-athletic crowd at school, you know what I'm saying? Like when everyone was out playing football down the graveyard with birds and fucking smoking and all that, do you know what I mean? This is Skream, you're watching Dubfiles.
Dubstep in America, it's growing. It's a growing phenomenon. It's expanding. It's exponential right now, man. It's growing by leaps and bounds. The sound is growing in so many places, so many different areas across the country. New York, Baltimore, San Francisco, Los Angeles, Houston, even in North America, in areas like Vancouver, Toronto. The sound is just growing, man. It's a beautiful thing. It's a good question. I would think the mecca or the focal point of dubstep in America is really two places. San Francisco, obviously, with the Grime City Boys, with Child and Subtech and Monk and Jamin and the One and everybody else out there. But I think the real parties, the Dub War Party in New York City, with myself as one of the residents, MC Juke Ali is the resident MC, and Dave Q is, I guess, the mastermind of the whole Dub War idea and the whole party and everything else, with helping booking overseas acts and bringing the residents in and other local talent from the New York City and the national area. Dub War would be the party, New York City, yeah, definitely. Well, I guess getting into dubstep was really more of me getting into electronic dance music. What I did is I was a Baltimore club DJ years and years and years ago. I used to play that. Then I got out of DJing. I just stopped playing. I lost the love for Baltimore club. I didn't touch the decks for like 3.5-4 years. But then I heard some old school garage. I heard old stuff by Wookie and all that old Master Step stuff from back in the day. Then I started hearing about horsepower, then hearing about dubstep, then I started buying dubstep, then one thing led to another, and that's kind of how I got into it. About 4 years ago, there's a party in Baltimore called Starscape, and a bunch of the big UK DJs that were playing the stuff that we now call dubstep were there. Guys like RSJ, Jada Flex, Benny Ill was there, Zed Bias was there, and Hatcha was there. And Hatcha was playing all these old tunes, old Scream and Benga tunes that are now classic tunes now. He had them on dub plate back then. This was the middle of 02. And I'm listening to these tunes and I'm just like, damn, that's, and I was already sort of getting into dubstep back then, you know, playing a lot of horsepower stuff, earlier Mark I stuff and Plastic Man stuff. And then one thing led to another and here I am now, just being all about dubstep and I love it. Oh man, there were a bunch of tunes that night, man. That RSJ tune, Set the Spider, that Benga tune, Skank, the Scream tune, The Bug. Oh man, what else? That Zed Bias tune, Ring the Alarm, that remix he did, they were all played that night, and every single tune, I was just like, damn, that's, big tune, another big tune after big tune. And that's what, it was the bass that got me hooked on the sound. It was the depth of the sound, it was the bass, it was the emotion that you get out of the music, and that's what really got me into the sound, and I was hooked from there on. It's gotten popular because there's something in it for everybody. There's something in it for everybody. There's bits and pieces of sounds that everybody likes from other forms of music. There's bits and pieces of house, there's bits and pieces of breaks and techno and dub and reggae. And there's bits and pieces of everything that everybody likes, and there's something in it for everybody. And if you're willing to look hard enough to find what you're looking for in the music, you have no choice but to like dubstep. You know, because it's everything is there. You just gotta find what you like out of it. You know, if you like big bass on a big system, it's there. If you like these synths that are sounding atmospheric, it's there. If you like dub, it's there. If you like reggae, it's there. If you just like something that sounds sort of breaky, it's there too. Everything's there, man. It's like the Swiss Army knife of music, you know what I mean? You pick up a Swiss Army knife, you got all these different pieces, and there's something there for you to use. That's dubstep. There's something in it for everybody. Honestly, I love the sound, man. I'm a DJ, I'm a lover of music. I'm always looking to try to find something different and something fresh, you know? I'm always trying to get the crowd hyped up with the sets and get everybody involved, you know? And for me, that's what's most important. Anything that's about growing the sound and getting people out to come and hear it and getting people to buy records or listen to my sets or listen to my radio shows or anything about that or any of the other radio shows, that's what I'm about. I love it. All DJs need to do this one of these days. It's called grab bag. What you do is you turn your record bag around, and everybody writes the names of the dub plates on the sleeves. What you do is you turn the sleeves around, right? And you have people in the crowd come out and pull the dubs. That way they know you're not planning your sets. So you just pick a tune, you play it. Next person comes up, picks a tune, you play it. Grab bag, keeps the whole night moving. Everybody knows at that point you're not planning your sets, and you don't know what you're gonna play next until you actually look at the tune and say, okay, oh, it's this. Then you play it. Grab bag. It's the next trick in DJing, trust me, I'm innovating. Right now, if I had to pick one tune right now, it's a Chrome Star tune called Path of Jah. Every time I play it, it's just pull-ups, fives, rewinds, lifts-ups, every single time. And I'm gonna play that tonight. It's gonna go down big. So that might be my tune right now. But there's a bunch of tunes. There's so much good music out. And there's so much good music from not necessarily just London, there's so much good music everywhere. You know what I mean? I'm not even talking just London. There's Bristol, there's Leeds, there's different parts of America. You got Sweden, Norway, and Finland. There's Spain, there's Japan. There's so many people out here that are making the sound right now, and it's helping to grow the sound. So, I mean, for me to pick one tune, I mean, it's tough, you know what I mean? But there's so much good music out there, man. It's a good thing for everybody. The one thing that's a beautiful thing about the internet is everybody can get what they want when they want it. It isn't like 5 or 6 years ago where you had to wait for something to come out and wait and wait and wait and listen and hope and pray that a big tune that you heard in the club will come out. You don't have to wait for it anymore. If you want to hear it, you can get it online, you can listen to it, someone's going to play it on radio, you can download it, listen to it, put it on your iPod, get on the tube, listen to it, put it in your car, listen to it. It's beautiful, man. I mean, hell, without the internet, you know, I'm not sure the sound would grow as much as it has. Hell, I'm not sure I would be where I am right now. You know what I mean? So many people found out about what I was doing because I was doing a radio show that was all dubstep in America, geez, a little more than 3 years ago. And people started hearing about it, and that was basically through the internet. It wasn't like I was calling people up on my cell phone in London saying, yo, I'm Joe Nice, listen to my show. I mean, people were just finding out about it overseas. And so many things are happening now because of the internet. You're having sharing of music, sharing of tunes. People are getting a hold of you for bookings and that sort of thing. Obviously, MySpace is big, because so many people not only are finding out about tunes, but they're able to connect with other people from other parts of the world and other parts of London and other parts of America. The internet's been a big role. Without the internet, a lot of things wouldn't be the same, including what we're dealing with right now in dubstep. Wow, American artists, guys from the States. There's a few of them, actually. Moldy, I think, is one of them. Moldy made he's a drum and bass producer primarily, but he started making some very, very big tunes. He actually has his own label coming out called, I can't even remember the name of the label, but there's a couple tunes coming out on a label of his. He just started it up. One of them is called Black Forest Dub. It's a monster tune. Another drum and bass guy from America, he's actually from San Francisco, named Juju. I think a lot of drum and bass heads would know who he is. He's got his own label called Narco Hertz. He's got a couple releases out, and he's got his own party called Futuro. It's in San Francisco, and I think it's a dubstep monthly party. That's going off pretty well right now. There's a bunch of other heads in America. Matty G's, I think from San Jose, California. He's got some absolute corkers, some absolute big tunes coming out on a couple of labels. Him and Nick Argon, they're doing some big things. So there's about at least three right now, and you got Jukali, who's an MC, but he does more dance hall stuff. But he's doing a lot more things with dubstep. Secret Agent Gel is another one. He's got another bunch of big tunes coming out from him. He's also in New York. You're gonna hear a lot of things from him in the not too distant future, especially in the new label, the Dub War Recordings label. It's a 3-track EP that's coming out within the next, I'd say, 6 to 8 weeks. So there's quite a few Americans that are you need to keep your ears open for, definitely. There's so much good music out. And there's so much good music from not necessarily just London, there's so much good music everywhere, you know what I mean? And I'm not even talking just London, there's Bristol, there's Leeds, there's different parts of America. You got Sweden, Norway, Finland, there's Spain, there's Japan. There's so many people out here that are making the sound right now, and it's helping to grow the sound. So, I mean, for me to pick one tune, I mean, it's tough, you know what I mean? But there's so much good music out there, man, and it's a good thing for everybody. Man, just learning production, learning how to wrap my head around reason. More DJ bookings, more everything, more radio shows. I'd like to do a mixed CD, hopefully a Dubstep All-Star CD in the near future. Fingers crossed, we'll see what happens, man. I'm just gonna, like I said, keep my head to the sky and keep going strong. It's the only way I know how to do it. Joe Nice, Dubstep DJ, representing Baltimore, Maryland, USA. 410 Formula.
I'm D1 and you're watching Dubfiles. Ah, the killer question. Dubstep. I don't know. I think Jason from Transition got the best view on that. It's a heavy bass and a big snare, innit? Like, I'd agree with that. I suppose that's a good thing about dubstep. It's quite new still, so to really classify, it's still like finding itself, I'd say. Like, there's loads of different sounds coming out from loads of different producers. So, I mean, I can't really say dubstep's exactly this. I mean, maybe a year ago you'd have said dubstep was half step music, and then 2 years before that you'd have said dubstep is conga music. So it keeps on changing, it keeps on progressing. So there's still a long way to go before you can kind of look back and say, oh, dubstep's this. I think personally it's musical. There's been arguments as whether I even make dubstep, kind of, I don't know, but it's a bit more musical. But then I suppose I'm musically influenced. Like, I played the piano from about 7, I played the saxophone. So I mean, that little family from that, like, mum and dad's side are both quite musically influenced as well. So I mean, I've always been more for chords and melodies and that, whereas I suppose some people argue dubstep's quite bass heavy, but I'm coming from, I suppose, a different angle. I think sometimes I'm overcrowd my tunes with a bit too much music, but that's something I've got to work on. But yeah, I suppose it's just the more musical side. You will hear the odd dark thing from me, but I'm more personally into like the more musical stuff and the more kind of mellow deep stuff that's going on with dubstep. I'm a bit rusty. I haven't played it since I was about 14, but it would be good. I'd definitely like to do that. Definitely, it'd be a good look. That's something I'd like to think in maybe 10 years you could do a proper session, like where you're just live instruments playing the like dubstep music in it. Like, it'd be good to see it sort of grow to that kind of level and status. That would be quite good. But yeah, I mean, I could even play this. I've played saxophone on some of my tunes. You know what I mean? Some certain saxophone bits and that. I've only been to Belgium, innit? I ain't really done too many, but I haven't done no real bookings outside of London. But I mean, the plan is to get to see the world for free is all right. Do you know what I mean? Like getting to go to loads of countries to DJ, that would be quite nice. But I mean, they'd come, like I said earlier, I mean, I'm more a producer than I'm a DJ. So, I mean, yeah, it'd be good to get bookings, but I'd want to make sure that I always kept up to date with tunes and that, and I wouldn't slack on that side, because that means a bit more to me than what DJing does. So in that sense, I mean, just
to get enough bookings to make sure I've got money in my pockets, alright, so I can get some McDonald's at the end of the week and shit. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, I feel alright, do you know what I mean? Like, if you listen to like a personal DJ set of mine, you'll hear like a lot, everything's got a lot more musical, a lot. I think, obviously, you're always going to improve as a music producer. Like, there's no point in really doing it unless you are improving. And it was just, you know, when I was making tunes back then, like Crap Bomb and tunes like that, I don't think I was really utilising the skills that I actually had to its fullest. Not necessarily because I didn't want to, just I didn't really know how to incorporate it into what I wanted to do, but sort of after a couple of years, you begin to realise how you can do that. And I'm beginning to do that, like, now. I think in the last year, I've really been making stuff that, like, I'm, like, I don't know if it'd be right to say personally feeling, but, like, I'm beginning to make stuff that I feel is more me. I'm actually would have said that, though, when I made Crap Bones, so I suppose it's a bit of a pointless comment, but I do really like what I'm doing at the moment. I'm quite happy with what I'm doing, and I think it's definitely gone in a more musical direction, I suppose, where maybe dubstep is quite defined by its bass lines and the heavy bass and the weight of the bass. I suppose my music's not necessarily always like that. I do still make tunes like that, but I think at the moment it's a lot more stuff that's more concentrated on the chord progression and stuff like that than what it is on beats and bass. Dion, the producer, without a doubt. The worst thing is, yeah, I suppose everyone say this, I'm the best bedroom DJ on the planet. Me by myself, bruv, like, I can mix without headphones, bruv, but when I get in front of a crowd, I'm pots and pans, bruv, all the way, bruv, do you know what I'm saying? But, no, I'm definitely D1 the producer. I do like to DJ, though, it's a good buzz, like, I love DJing, innit? And I've spent so much money on dubs, I need to DJ, you get me? But, like, no, definitely D1 the producer, man. But it's good to DJ, just to interact with the crowd and to watch a tune go off because you know you've played it and that's a nice feeling, definitely. But yeah, I stick to production, man, definitely. I can take a positive from most forms of music there. There's not a form of music I've ever heard of, but man, that is disgusting. I'm grade 8 piano, I'm grade 5 music theory, I'm grade 2 tenor sax. I'd love that. If there was ever the opportunity to do like a live session, drummers, guitarists and all that stuff, I'd love to play the piano and that. The strong influences, I mean, from a young age to even today, I love to listen to like Thelonious Monk and John Coltrane and all the old jazz musicians. My nan does a Billie Holiday impression, so I've heard bare Billie Holiday as well, so that's been quite jokey as well. So like, I've grown up listening to like a lot of jazz music and that, but then I played classical piano, so that gave me an appreciation for the whole classical music thing. And then my dad and that, he's mostly made every bit of music you could think of, but like, he sort of growing up, I can just remember hearing like a lot of happy hardcore, house, jungle do you know what I mean? So there's loads of influences. I mean, I could never really pinpoint and say I personally think that my music comes from this, because you might listen to the tune and disagree where it comes from, so I'm not gonna say that. But I mean, yeah, there's tons of influences. I'm 15 and I was like, oh, sod school, which ain't a good thing, by the way, but like, I was like, forget school. But I was like literally going to school from like 10 o'clock till lunchtime, running, getting a train from New Malden to Waterloo and then Waterloo to Black Market, like, and just going to check youngsters. Obviously, like, me and him built up a bit of a rapport and just got to know each other quite well. Then I started to make beats, like, seriously, like, wanting to make beats. And I was giving youngsters tapes. I didn't even have a CD rewriter these times, so I was giving, man, TDK 90s, bruv. So, like, I was giving enough of those and he'd, you know, like, I think where Youngster was still making a name for himself, I think he'd only just got on Ritz and he was doing like the 1 till 3 or something like that, the mad hour show, like, he didn't even have tasks these times, like, he was just DJing by himself, saying, yeah, this is Youngster, like, so like, those days, so like, he was quite willing to kind of help me out, show me where I was going wrong and what I could do to make my tunes better or more accessible to play and stuff like that. So, I mean, it took like a good year of that before like he started cutting my first beats and that. That all happened and like, you know, he started playing some tunes and then a Crap Bong happened. And then it was after that like had a meeting with Ammunition and that. And it was sort of like, we just agreed, yeah, like, we'll just do this temper thing. And I mean, at the end of the day, like, they're a massive label, innit? Like, so as an artist, you want to be with kind of the cream of the crop, if that would be the right word to say, innit? So, like, I was quite willing to do that. I mean, it's just been good. I mean, it's, I suppose if I was to have maybe tried and done it myself, I wouldn't have ever emotionally released a beat. So, you know, to know that I can make a tune and then they can release it and they can deal with it, and that it takes a lot of pressure off me. I can just carry on making beats and kind of live in this free imaginary world of mine, innit? Like, so like, that's a good thing, but I mean, yeah, that's our temper. I was 16 when I made that tune. That was the third tune that Youngster had ever cut of mine, and like, I remember standing at Forward, crap on. Do you know why I called it that, actually? I can actually think, honestly, now, because we was talking about it before, but the reason why I did generally call it that is because all my mates at the time, they were MCs and that, and I didn't have decks for a long time, and I used to DJ at youth centres and that, and I'd play this music, and they'd be like, this is crackhead music, you're a crackhead. So I'd be like, nah, bruv, trust me, this is going places, and they'd be like, nah, it's all about grime and hip-hop and all that stuff, so I'm like, all right. So I suppose making that tune, I was thought, crap on in it, so I suppose it don't really make sense in it, but to me it did at the time. But it is a regretful title in it for a tune. There's always like a new producer that's gonna like put a little spark in your sort of, I don't know if this is the right word, but to sort of up your game kind of. You always get that new producer that will do something quite refreshing. So as long as that keeps on happening, I mean, the music will keep moving forward, which is a good thing. The nights are getting good, there's more girls. So for anyone who says they know girls that know dubstep raves, trust me, there's a couple now still. But I mean, it's just enjoyable still. It's still quite, it's not got too like moody or anything, and like it's still quite nice, and you can, you know, I personally I'll go to Forward dress like this, innit? I wouldn't really feel no way. So as long as I carry on feeling like that, I mean, dubstep's still gonna be good to me, innit? So there's nothing I can really say much bad about it at the moment. It's still growing, innit? Don't take no notice of the studio, but like, I pride myself on the fact that that speaker's got no tweeter in it, and it's in the wrong place. It shouldn't be over there. That one's got a tweeter, and I've been working with that for about 4 or 5 months. That's like a P, that's my PC, but it's like, I've got it made up, like. And it's done, it's, you know something? The amount of fucking dirty shit that's been downloading on this year, it has not died on me yet, so like, considering I think I'm musical, that is what I use as a keyboard. That is shocking, considering I've got a massive keyboard upstairs in my bedroom, but what can I say, innit? And that's the screen, man. Trust me, I've nearly killed my eyes with this. Like, I get headaches all the time looking at this, so I might have to upgrade to the flat screen soon. But I'll tell you honestly why I'm the biggest cunt on road. Because I've got a G5 sitting upstairs with Logic Pro 7, and I'm still not using it yet, and I've had it for about 6 months. So, to be honest, this is just one little thing I'm doing. It's not mixed down, so if you see the little red light in the bottom corner, don't watch it. This is the new thing. But this is what I'm just saying about musical things, like, just... MySpace. Oh, I'll check what that is in a sec. I can't remember. I tried to set one up, yeah, and I'm so dumb here, I set one up in not the music section. So I've gone to upload tunes, it won't only let me upload one tune, and like, I'm like, what? But so I had to redo it, so I'm not too sure what's what, but my MySpace thing is myspace.com/D1DJ, innit? So check that out for everyone that's, you know what I mean, wants to get in contact with. But I'll warn people now, I'm slack. So if I say I'm going to send you a CD, it will take me about a week, innit? So I don't want, you know, I just want to clarify this for anyone that I've ever let down with tunes or CDs and shit like that. It's not personal. It's just me, innit? Like, whatever you're doing, innit? Just firstly, believe in it. Be accepting of criticism, innit? At the end of the day, it's only going to help you. But know when someone's just criticising you to put you down, and know when someone's criticising you to help you. But I mean, it always believe in what you're doing, and just try and be as different as you can. I mean, I won't lie, when I first came into the scene, some of the tunes that I were making, I would turn around now and say sounded like other people. That's a thing that I think happens. But as you maybe get more involved in the scene, and as you build in more beats and stuff, you'll grow out of that anyway, and you'll come into your own. But I mean, just believe in what you're doing. If it feels that, oh, no one wants to play my beats and blah blah blah, it's nothing like that. You just need to carry on striving and doing what you're doing, and then Dubstep's getting big now. So I mean, it's like the openings are there, they're always there. I don't really know what the plan is, but I suppose there should be more releases, really. Hopefully more of the musical stuff that I'm doing, not so much like the proper hard stuff. Not that I don't mind that, but it'd just be good to, I think, for people to see maybe a more varied side of what I do than just, you know what I mean, chipmunk tunes or just the hard bass heavy stuff. I'd like to see a couple more musical things come out for myself personally. I'm D1 and you're watching Dubfiles/X-Files/ fucking FBI files / bear shit.
Eleven years been DJing. Started drum and bass, fucking jungle, all that stuff. When I was about fucking 10, 11 when I got my decks. Started getting serious into it about 13, 14. Got on pirate radio when I was 15, up front, and just didn't stop. Just kept going and going. Dubstep's new, it's fresh, you know what I mean? This ain't different. It's a nice environment of people. The raves are always good. It's more of a DJing kind of scene, do you know what I mean? Whereas all the garage scene and the grime scene, well, only them scenes really, which I was involved with, they was more like focused on the MCs. DJ would just be up in the box where it was dark, just DJing, all the focus would be on the stage with the five MCs and all that. But now it's a pioneered kind of sound. You have to know what you're doing, and when you're DJing, do you know what I mean? People can see, they're watching you, appreciate what you're doing. So you get feedback that, so that's when you enjoy being a DJ. Back in the day, we were just starting. Everyone was just coming together, throwing a party. We were just starting, seeing what was happening, do you know what I mean? Forward started. Sarah Soldier, she started that night. Yeah, just built from there. Do you know what I mean? Started a nice little community with like people and that. Started coming down there, word got about. Yeah, it's good. Then they got a regular night every Friday night. That's now RAM every week. There's another night, DMZ. They do that once a month. That's all Digital Mystic slot. That's like the big one, like a couple of thousand people. Dubstep All Stars, Volume 1, mixed by me, Hatcha. And then the next one was Volume 4, I just done with Youngster. Now you can buy all different volumes up to 5. And you can, it will take you through the dubstep kind of eras, which is good. It's got different DJs on it, so every CD is a different style. Like, that was just my interpretation of dubstep there and then. They were the, like, producers that were doing it at the time. And like, yeah, it's a good crossover, do you know what I mean, of how it come together and whatnot. Now, I suppose, you've got a lineup of DJs. Every DJ's got his own style of dubstep, which is a good thing, because you ain't got a night of just the same fucking music. So yeah, it's good, man, it's good. Oh, it's kicking off everywhere, serious. It is, America's booming, it's bad out there, wicked feedback. All over Europe's kicking. Everyone's like feeling it, do you know what I mean? You turn up to raves now and there's a few hundred people waiting there for you. Rather than back in the days, it was 80 people, 100 people. Now it's a good few hundred people. They're coming through from everywhere though, even abroad. There's some proper shit-up producers, you know, that are knuckling down on it, spending good money on equipment and proper focusing on it. So yeah, it's growing quick, man. Like, you'd hear a dubstep set and you wouldn't have heard any of the producers that have made any of the music now. And it'd still be an alright set. All the Digital Mystics lot, they always produce good stuff. Benga, Skream, fucking there's a couple of people abroad that are doing good stuff at the moment. D1 and that, Chrome Star, loads of them. Loads and loads, I could go on forever. It's hard to keep yourself in touch with the producing side of it, but knowing them all, I can just jump in with each one of them like every now and again. So that's what I do every couple of months. I just get an EP out with someone, do you know what I mean? Whoever it's gonna be. But last couple of months have been quite busy, do you know what I mean? I've done a few bits for like Southside, Dubstars, Planet Moo, loads of stuff. Loads of EPs we just finished that we're sending out. And yeah, it's all going well, man. It's coming together nice. Yeah, every Tuesday night, Kiss. And just everybody forward, like nearly every Friday when we get time. And then we're out of the country just as much as we're in the country, do you know what I mean? If not more. Abroad, so it's hard now. But for regular dubstep, every week it's going to be forward. Do you know what I mean? And then you just hear of them from there. It just happens. This is me and Crazy D show on Kiss every Tuesday night at 1 o'clock. He's away in Jamaica. So tonight we'll have Viper covering Viper and Mighty Mo next week. And yeah, we'll get some covers in for him and all that. But yeah, it's all right. Like, the scene is fucking growing fast, man. Everyone's booked everywhere. And it wasn't like that last year. I can see it going big. Like, it will blow, without a doubt. So, all the time, all the work, it would have paid off, hopefully. Do you know what I mean? That's where I'm hoping it to go. So things are only getting better by the year, so I can only see it keep going that way. I run Big Apple Records with two other guys, John and Artwork as well. And our first release with Benga and Skream, Digital Mystics. Just done a double pack with Benga. That's flying out. Coke EP, be out in a couple of weeks. So the label's going good and strong at the moment as well. That all like originated from the record shop. I used to work in Big Apple. All the labels seem to be going well at the moment. So that's another good sign. Screaming that, I know their brother, like his older brother and that, from the shop from when I was young. Then I knew Scream when they was at school. They was like more younger kids. They weren't till like Scream and that started getting involved in music. Like put him to one side and like, right, we'll collar you while you're young. Like young, do you know what I mean? Yeah. Put him down that path. All you can do is just like guide them in the right way and just let them go. Then they do it themselves. It's how much time they want to put into it, how far they want to take it. So yeah, I'm quite happy that they focused on it, and that is now their living, Benga and Scream, because I knew them and their family and all that. So I've known Benga and Scream since they were like tiny, do you know what I mean? Now they're both fucking taller than me. They were sending their music out to record labels, and people weren't even giving them the time of day. And then I was taking their fucking CDs, cutting them onto dub, playing them in the dance, and it was fucking going off. And then people see what was happening. It's like, right, we'll have your CDs next time. You're watching Dubfiles, and I'm DJ Hatcha.
Well, I say what got me into dubstep was sort of really through grime. Like, they were the first sort of things I started hearing. Like, I used to be quite big into electronica and that kind of thing, and the grime compilations on Reflex. None of my friends liked it, but I just relentlessly played the Plastic Man tracks, Pump Up the Jam and Industrial Graft. Like, just used to play them over and over, and then the second one came out and sort of, I was quite feeling it, but then it was a grower. That was the one with the Mystics on it and Code 9. And that sort of grew up. And then Simon Scott again from Tribe Records, he put Digital Mystics on at Subdub. And like, I've been into the grime, and then sort of at that time, the MCs were getting big on the grime, and I wasn't really feeling it. I was sort of kind of into the dub and the drum and bass, but there was nothing there at the time really, because what I thought could be really good had sort of petered out and not been too good. But then I saw Digital Mystics on a system, like way, way, way back when they were proper early on the bill, like real short set playing all like the Rough and all the kind of the old Mystics tunes, all the old stuff, some of the tribally sounding ones. And yeah, it just blew me away. I was like, yeah, that's it. And there's Distinction, another big DJ up in Leeds. He was already well onto it, and I was at the College of Music, Leeds College of Music, doing the same course as him, music production. But I didn't really know him that well, because it's like, just kind of stuck to who I was with at the time. And then, yeah, as I say, like, once I knew that he was kind of DJing that kind of thing, I was like, oh, so you like this kind of dubstep thing, do you? And then he was sort of just starting off at the same time, and he was sort of getting a few DJ bookings, and then he played down at the first ever DMZ they did up in Leeds. That was around the time I started making my first dubstep tunes. Sort of, he played one or two of them out and just sort of kind of got friendly with him, really, and just went from there. We just found then that was when the dubstep forum was on the internet. I've been producing for ages and ages. I used to make loads of cut and paste hip hop, and as I say, I play guitar and bass and saxophone and drums, and I have done for a long time, and I used to record a lot of live instrument music and that sort of stuff. So I've been producing for a long, long, long time, and used to be in bands, but then I got tired of working with other people, to be honest. I just wanted to, you know what I mean, sort of do my own thing, and didn't want ideas to be sort of polluted by other people. I was in loads and loads of bands when I was like up to the age of about 17, 18, playing bass and sax and reggae bands and rock bands, and I just had to work on my own. I went right through college doing music and music technology, and then on to Leeds College of Music again to do music production. And I've just, that's all I've ever done. I'm rubbish at sport, rubbish at anything else. All I've ever done is music. I moved from Leeds to London in August last year. I've lived here for about 5 months. Even if you listen to like the last songs I made in Leeds and the first songs that I made in London, you can tell there's a difference instantly. But I think living with another producer and living with people who like that kind of music. Last year I lived with friends, kind of, but I was very separate, you know what I mean? It was a communal shared living room, but I was just spent time, you know, in the studio on my own, doing my own thing. So coming to London and being around everybody and having people coming around every day and living with people making music and like getting feedback and stuff, it's just trebled. I just try and get that sort of kind of steppy, like digital dub flavour sort of running through them all. But recently I've been sort of trying a bit more harder stuff, but still retaining that kind of dub bounce and kind of as much melody as I can sort of get in there, really. For the listener, to hear melodies, like a lot more melodies, when a lot of the stuff, especially earlier on, was a bit sparse. Like, some people love it, some people hate it. It definitely divides people, I think. Because some people just like the dark, sort of minimal, kind of bassline stuff. And then a lot of other people like melodies. And I think a lot of sort of mainstream people obviously like the more melodic stuff. But yeah, I think making more melodic stuff and dubby stuff. I mean, a lot of my dubstep, like, I wouldn't even really say dubstep, it's just dub. You know what I mean? Like, one or two tracks, which I wouldn't even say is dubstep. They're 140, and you can mix them in nicely, but I wouldn't class them as dubstep. I'd just say it was just straight dub. So for me, there's a very thin line. I might start off making a tune that's dubstep and finish up with a dub tune, or start off making a dub tune and finish up with a heavy, heavy dubstep tune. So, like, for me, there's really not much of a line. As long as it's all around the same tempo, 135, 140. For me, there's not really a separation, because when I play a set, a DJ set, I'll play 50% like dub tunes, Bush Chemist, Aeration Steppers, Vibronics, that sort of hard stepping digital dub, and, you know, 50% sort of dubstep tunes. I'll just mix it up straight, sort of half and half. Forward and kind of raves like that, like the one they did Red Down at the Red Star, I get all kinds of people, like, just random DJs, people from abroad, like guys from Finland, just come up and ask me for a CD. They say, Rusko, have you got any beats that you can let off? And obviously, not everything I make is coming out, so quite often there is. And yeah, most of the time I just say, yeah, let a couple of bits off. But I do get, yeah, people ask quite a lot. And I think that's, a lot of producers would be like that as well. You know, at least be friendly with it anyway. And I think the way it is, but people feel like they can ask people. It's that accessible that people feel like they can just go up to a big producer and say, you know that tune, you know, are you letting it off at the moment? Can I have it, sort of thing? You know, it's that kind of thing where people feel like they can do that, which is good. The setup is not a lot, really. I've just got the deck all for the samples, going through the mixer, little MIDI keyboard and the old spare. I like the little ones. I like the mixer because yeah, it's got the surround sound. It's got a surround sound thing on the mixer and it's a bit bait, but I sometimes run my hi-hats and stuff through the mixer and back into my computer with the Behringer surround sound on. I haven't found anything quite like it to make it just sound real spatial and nice. And it's a bit of a kind of a ramshackle way of doing things, running it through a DJ mixer and then back into the computer. But since I've sort of been doing that on the mixdowns, it's got a lot better. So I guess it just kind of works. Well, I've just got a normal PC running Sony Acid Pro, really. I do everything in Acid Pro, which is mostly a lot of audio and just VSTs. Every single person I've met has their monitors in front of them, and I don't turn round to listen to the tunes. I have to have them behind me, because when I was making tunes back in my mum's house back in the day, like, that was just where the speakers were of my hi-fi in relation to the computer when I first started putting beats together in Acid 2. Would you believe? And I followed it all up for 3, Acid 4, Acid 5. That's where the speakers were, just behind me, behind my head. And then when I moved out and went to university, sort of like, I put them in front of me like everyone else where they should be, where I was taught at university that monitors should be to hear the mix properly. And it just didn't feel right. It's got to be behind my head and loud. I'd like to see more nights that are successful with a much more bigger variety of DJs. I think that's the main thing, is there's just a monopoly on nights. There needs to be more. I'm sure everybody said there needs to be more dubstep nights, I can imagine. There just seems to be lots more international involvement in the last sort of 6 months or so. And I think that's just gonna go crazy. I think the future, hopefully, will hold more bookings. Yeah, I think the Dubstep Forum is still the centre. Everybody goes there to, even if it's just to advertise their night or their release or whatever, it's still sort of regarded as central to a lot of things. But yeah, I think the internet was, right, it wouldn't have grown, it wouldn't be like it is, obviously, without the internet. All right. No, definitely the internet was massive, just purely because of pirate radio. Lots and lots of radio shows broadcasting online, you know, it brought Rint FM to everybody, and everybody could listen to the old Quietstorm sets. I was well into the dubstep, but I wasn't really making it at that time. And then I sort of did a few tunes and whacked them up on the old MySpace, and Luke Envoy heard them and was big into them, sent me some messages. I was like, well, just sort of off the cover. Didn't really expect anything off it. I was DJing a bit of dubstep at the time, and I made a few sort of 30-second dubby dubstep thing, 3-minute dubstep sort of dubby dubstep things, just to put into my sets when I was DJing, but I wasn't really making it properly. And I put them on my MySpace, and sort of Luke Envoy got in touch, and he was like, "Yeah, they're massive. I really like them." And sort of, I'll give them to Quietstorm. Gave them to Quiet, and he was like, "Yeah." Got in touch, phoned me up, and said he wanted to do a first release, and I was like, massive. I was loving it, absolutely loving it. That was when I was up in Leeds, and I just sort of cracked on with that and went on, and then sort of my housing contract was running out in the house I was living in. I was thinking, shall I go down to London? Shall I not? But yeah, since I moved down, everything sort of tripled, really. Loads of bookings, like more releases, different labels, sort of. Yeah, this is that Jehovah tune. With the Congo Natty sample. Drop an orange. It's iron brew or Tizer, bruv. Iron brew or Tizer and coffee. I don't eat a lot when I'm making tunes because I just forget. I just sort of forget to eat, and as long as I've got a big bottle of pop and some smokes, I can sort of keep going for most of the day. And then when I stop, like, I'm like super hungry, need the toilet. Everything that I sort of forgot about for the last few hours sort of comes back to me. So as soon as I stop making beats after a few hours, I straight to the toilet and in the kitchen. Sure, your drums are powerful. A lot of people, sort of when they first start making, concentrate on the bass line and the drums aren't powerful enough. And I'm guilty of that. My old tunes, the drums aren't powerful enough, but I think that really, the snare drum has got to almost have as much punch as the kick drum, I would say. So make sure that your snares and your kicks have got as much punch and clarity as you can. That would be my one big bit of advice. And also cram in as much melody as you can. Yeah, cram in the melodies if you can, even just for 8 bars, and never drop it in again. Just to get it in there. Yeah, get your melodies in there, and make sure your snares punch. That was my top tip. I'm Rusko and you're watching Dubfiles.
Hello, I'm Crazy D and we're watching Dubfiles. I've roughly been doing dubstep about 6-7 years. Yeah, about that. My dubstep MCing evolved through MCing through garage, bedroom MC for when it comes to drum and bass. It was jungle back then, but then mainly garage, and then it evolved through that basically. Dubstep means music to me, so but it's I guess it's a mix of for me, garage and a bit of techno, a little bit of house. It's got a little bit of elements, a bit of reggae mixed up into one kind of thing. So yeah, that's dubstep, I'd say. While on the dubstep scene is a bit more relaxed. I'm not really, I mean, I know a few grime MCs and a few drum and bass MCs, and what they do and I do is a little bit different. Same thing as in you want the crowd to be hype, but what I try to do is keep it a bit more relaxed and more about the music, because a lot of people that follow dubstep, they mainly for the music, so. I've traveled a fair bit through the dubstep scene. Mainly Europe. What can I say about it? It's quite big. It's bigger than I thought it would be. I mean, most places I've been to has been only once. So really, you guys are ramping. Should be getting me out there more often. But yeah, it's quite big. What can I say? Basically, Hatcha brought Crazy D back from the dead, because I was on a local radio station kind of thing. We both was on there. I was on there for longer than him, obviously. But then the station finished, and I was gonna finish with it. But Hatcha pulled me out the gutter, said, you know, we're gonna come and do this for me. I love you, rare, diddy rare. So I was like, yep, we'll do that. And then the rest is history, basically. It's been a hard work. It's been, like I say, 6-7 years for doing just dubstep. I mean, and I'm from old school garage, so when, from back then, when you was trying to get booked for doing dubstep, there was nowhere, so, but now there's. I'd say from 2002 onwards, I mean, mainly from 2005, I'd say, 2006 even, a lot of people jumped on. And when the main majority of people did jump on, it was healthy, it was very healthy. Mainly people were getting involved in the later stages of, because the music's evolving, I guess. The more people that get involved is the different angles, oh cheers, is the different angles that you come from. So there's a bit of reggae influence, a bit of hip hop influence, a bit of everything, so I guess that's what's made about. What would I like to see in this scene to make it better? More girls, obviously. What else? I mean, the music's fine. Maybe more MCs, maybe not. I'm trying to do an album right now, a few different various producers, but it's kind of on the down low right now and there's no rush. So I've been producing beats for years and years before I even started MCing, but obviously not very seriously because nothing's come out, but just, I'm a bit of a bedroom music maker, I guess. That's about it right now, yeah. I mean, I'm concentrating on the MCing thing. Yeah, the internet has been extremely, I'd say, good in the sense that it's been spreading dubstep more than, say, going to clubs and things like that, because there's not been a lot of clubs that was playing dubstep. And when they was booking Hatcha many, many years ago, it was for old school, and he was going out and playing old school while we was here grafting. So, so he had that option where I didn't. So yeah, the internet's been great for Dubstep. Big up the internet and the Dubstep forum. My influences come from different types of music, really, when I'm MCing, when I'm thinking about writing my MC and my lyrics. Mainly hip-hop, I'd say, and reggae. Those are my two upbringings, so that's what it is, I guess. When I'm not doing Dubstep, I'm not doing nothing, basically. I'm at home, a dad. Daddy. The future holds for Crazy D? Ooh, I don't know. I'd like to answer that. Hopefully I could be around here for another 10 years. What can I say? Anything beyond that? Lovely. Other DJs I'm feeling in the Dubstep scene right now are N Type, Youngstar, Rusko's coming up a bit now, Headhunter has been surprising me recently. Who else? The usual crowd, really. You got your Digital Mystics, obviously. Hatcha, my boy. Skream, Benga. Benga's my producer right now for the music that he's producing right now. So yeah. If you wanna come and find me, Crazy D, I'll be at Forward each and every Friday, Plastic People, 147 Curtin Road, EC2. Get yourself down there. Yeah. I guess my catchphrase would be my woe in. And I know you're gonna say. Yeah. Whoa, whoa, whoa! That's it. That's my catchphrase. So if you hear that, then that's me, Crazy D. I'm Crazy D. Once again, you're watching Dubfiles. All of the crew, them big up. Yeah.
It's quite good when it's like a massive beam of light, though, isn't it? Like that. It's like interrogated. Getting interrogated. What's that in your car, mate? What's that in your car? The boot bar. I've got my suit and everything in here, look. Fucking, I've got a bit of some nice bit of cashmere. Look, cashmere. Oh, a bit of silk tie.
Quite worth a bit, that is.
Yeah, got a bit of a shirt and some test presses as well. And my Dubs. Don't forget my Dubs. And some shoes to go with it. What else have we got in here? We've got some boxes. I've got my boxes. Look how crap them boxes are. Look at them. They're like 1940s boxes, mate. The most important thing, we've got Stella Artois, mate. Get the Stellas in there. The N-Type boot bar. That's it. Boom. It's N-Type Dubstepper from Day. From Croydon ways as well. But I'm not actually from Croydon, but everyone thinks I'm from Croydon because all my mates are from Croydon, but I live out in Reigate, which is a mile away. Proper miles away, mate. Tonight, you come to watch me cut some dubs, which is gonna be fun, because it takes about a million years to cut about 5 dubs. But tonight, probably I'll cut 3, probably, hopefully. But the actual fact is, I've got all the Top Boy producers with me, but I don't actually know what tunes I've got to cut yet. So Jay, who runs Transition, has got to sit there while I finger through about a million tunes and work out which ones I'm gonna cut. So it's gonna be a bit of a mission, but like, we're in it for the stint. So yeah, that's what we're up to tonight, cutting some dubs. It's gonna be all right, mate. Lovely jubbly. We're in Forest Hill at the moment. This is a Transition dub cutting place. They do mastering and everything there as well. Like, they're probably the top boys in the game. Everyone from South are cutting dubs at Transition. They've been doing it for years, and they're cutting all the drummer bass dubs, all of the dubstep dubs, right through to reggae and stuff. And like, I've been coming here for years, man. These guys were the guys who taught me about cutting dubs and the way of the dub, really. So yeah, that's where we are today. Yeah, I've got quite a few things on this weekend, actually. I've got, tomorrow I'm playing at Forward, 12 to 1, and then we're heading down to Heaven for Hospitality, where we've got a Forward room down there, and I'm playing 3 till 4, I think. And then the next day, I've got to get up, which is going to be a killer, yeah? Because like, when you roll in at 4, yeah, when I finish at 4, I ain't rolling in home at 4. I've got to drive all the way back to fucking Reigate, do you know what I mean? Which is a trek. So I've got to get back there, go to bed, get up in the morning, then I've got to drive to bloody Stansted, mate. All the way up to Stansted, which is like, if there's the like M25, right, the bottom, it's like right to the other end. So I've got to go on a massive trek up the old What's It to get there, yeah? So yeah, I'm probably going to be knackered, but I'm flying out from there to Poland to do a set in Poland, and I'm staying in Poland till Monday, probably just getting on the piss and having a laugh, and yeah, then I'm coming home again on Monday. do some like tunes and that probably. Because I've just rushed here, got to get into the studio, have a quick listen to the tunes and that, work out what I want to cut, and then basically just start cutting. And what happens is, Jay or Leon, they sit down with the track, they listen through the track, and as they're listening to it, they're like mastering it, compressing it, or doing whatever they need to do to it before they cut it from the CD to a dub plate, which is cut on the lathe. And you'll see all that stuff working, it's heavy. Yeah, come through. Wait, my bottle of water, don't forget that, mate. Don't forget that. No, oh, no way. Dehydration, not on your nolly, mate. Now, this is Transition. It's my boy Iron Soul. He's a bad boy as well.
I've been DJing for, well, every time I think about it, I think like 10 years, and then I think, shit, I said that about 3 years ago, so I don't know, probably about, I don't know, about 12 years now, probably. But I started when I was like around about 13, 14. There was no real proper time, because I just used to muck about on my mate's decks, started buying tunes, then got some decks probably when I was about, I don't know, like 14, 14 and a half or something. So far back now, and so many raves, it's hard to remember, do you know what I mean? But it's getting wicked, so it's all good. Well, I got into dubstep because I originally was like a jungle DJ back in the day. And I like that kind of dark, like rolling sound with the kind of reggae and dub vibes on there as well. And I was playing a lot of that, but then I sort of started getting into like the garage sound because I liked what DJs like EZ were doing. And I liked listening to like the way he was mixing and the energy what you could get from garage. So I sort of got into garage, but I was never really feeling like all the light, like garage, you know, like, all that like flowers and all that. I was never really feeling all that sort of stuff. So like I naturally sort of took my own dark sort of side of garage and then started playing more of that sort of stuff. But I was buying jungle and garage at the same time. So I was like, well, I'm spending about £1 million here and I'm not really getting anywhere. Do you know what I mean? So I thought, right, stick with garage. And the more the garage sort of developed, it sort of started splitting into your like grime, your dubstep, and your like two-step and stuff like that. So like I sort of like went the dubstep way because like Hatcha, Benga, Skream, Benny Hill, all the boys from Croydon, all the Digital Mystics, all them boys, Loafer and that, they started making all the dubstep tunes and I was loving that, you know what I mean? So I started like buying that all up and cutting all that. So Hatcha taught me about cutting dubs. Before that, I went to a rave. I was like, how come all your tunes look the same? And he was like, oh, right, mate, you want to go and cut them here, innit? And that's how I got to learn about Transition. And he said, like, I'll go down there, Jay's safe, mate, nice, easy, you can master them, mix them up all nice. I was like, wicked. So that's where I started cutting all my dubs. And then this weird, I don't even know how far it is done right now. Jay, how long have I been cutting dubs here?
It feels like forever, to be honest with you. I've got to be honest.
Cheers, mate.
I've got no idea. It's been a few years.
Yeah.
Been a few years, I think, since we first saw you, probably, I don't know, three years, something like that.
He's cutting solid every week, like five dubs a week and sort of on average about, how much is now? Probably about three or four.
Thursday night, this is where it'll be.
Yeah, being late, because I'm always bloody late. I'm terrible. But yeah, no, these guys are wicked, man, and like they're family down here, do you know what I mean? They cut the heaviest dubs. The reason why I think it's important to cut dubs, right, is because at the moment, like the whole scene has changed, like from back in the day, like, there's a whole like quality control thing going on, right? Basically, a lot of the producers now are making tunes just on their like bedroom computer and stuff like that at home, and not going through the whole like mix down and mastering thing properly. So like a lot of the tunes coming out onto CD are like not mixed down right, and the frequencies and the bad sound what you get if you just take a CD into a club and start banging it out like a mental like 20k system is going to start damaging your hearing. Another thing is because I grew up on the whole dub plate era. Like I was always listening to like all the DJs like when I was a kid, like Mickey Finn, Groove Rider, all them boys, they were playing like the big tunes on dub, and that's what I was seeing in the dance. So that had an effect on me and I remember that, and that's what I grew up on. And like then when you see like Hatcha started cutting dubs, like he was playing them dubs and I learnt from him, and he was like, come and cut them here, this is the place to cut them. So I started like cutting them here. But I mean, another reason also is because people are out there buying vinyl, yeah? So like if you're playing everything on CD, it's a bad message to the people, because why they want to go out and buy like vinyl if you're just playing everything on CD? So that's another reason why I think it's really important to cut dubs, and it's the way really. Right, a typical N-type DJ set, what I try to do is like give it as much energy as possible, whether that be the tunes I play or the way I mix, and like try and create energy in the dance. what I've always tried to do is like build my sets, like kind of take people on a journey, if you know what I mean. Like what I try and do is build people up from the beginning. Like don't hit people too hard at the beginning, because if you like drop your biggest tune straight away at the beginning, you've got to kind of keep that level all the way through. So it's always a best thing to kind of like build your set, right? Stick some like good tunes, but not the banging best tunes in your box kind of thing at the beginning. You've got to kind of build it and take people up and then carry it along. And maybe I'll play a little bit of the newer experimental stuff in the middle, and then like out of that I'll bang like an anthem or something that people know, so it kind of brings people up again. And I try and like just build up the vibes so like people are just going mad by the end of it. Like that's what I try to do. I mean, I took influence from the way that I saw energy in other music like jungle or drum and bass, the way that people got rewinds and stuff in like that kind of like ragga thing and the grime thing as well. Like there's a lot of energy in those musics, and that was what I was trying to sort of bring into what I was doing. Alright, the best crowd to play to, I don't know, obviously like it's good when there's loads of girls in a dance, but like I reckon it's probably people who are kind of like willing to hear something new and willing to like let their hair down and just like dance and get on it, basically. Do you know what I mean? Because that's what I'm like when I'm in a dance. If I hear something good, I'm like, yeah, and I get on it and do really bad dancing and embarrass myself. That's what it's about, mate. Just having a laugh in a dance. It's always funny, I reckon, on radio. But like when I do my radio show, I always find it funny, right? Because I'm there and like I'm just talking to a wall. There's a wall, there's a couple of speakers and a mixer, but the only thing with the connection between me and everyone else in the world is like this little phone, and it's always like some like shabby like Tesco's like battered up phone. I'm just like, all right, mate, how's it going? And it's just funny, man. I'm just up there just like having a laugh, basically, like doing what I do like all the time. Like I try never to take things too seriously. Like obviously I take my music seriously, but I like to have a laugh with it and enjoy life, you know what I mean? At the end of the day, like that's what it's all about. For the dubstep scene grind, it's like millions of different like reasons for it, really. I think there was always strength in the sound, like from the day dot when people started making the music, there was always like a strength in it, and it was something that I instantly took to. And I think it's a sound that's really deep. It's got influence from loads of different sounds. It gives you energy. It also gives you like the time to sort of like chill out and nod your head, or like talk to your girl, or like chill out in the dance, that kind of thing. But it's got everything in it, really. And I think the reason why it's getting so big, because a lot of people from all these different music genres, like whether it be techno, jungle, whatever, really, all these different people are listening to it and saying, "Wow, I love that. It's heavy. It's so new." And the reason being is because it's got something for everyone in that sound. And I just think it will be one of the elite underground musics in the next however many years, and I think it pretty much already is at the moment. The international scene is mad. Like everywhere I've been, it's just been nuts. Like some of the places like I've played, it's like some people haven't heard the sound before, but they're really intrigued to see English artists coming out to their country. So they're like, right, all right, and we'll go along, see what it's like. And when they get there, I've had people coming up to me saying, "Oh, that's the best set I've seen in all these years, and you've changed my life," and all this sort of stuff. And it's crazy, but it's not really me, it's more the music and people. Like if you play the music a certain way to people, they experience it and they're like, "Wow, this is amazing." And I think that it's just blowing up worldwide. I mean, America's got it's like a massive scene out there, and it's got their own artists out there pushing out tunes as well. And there's some stuff out there starting to sound really nice. And like you got Germany, you're getting on it big time. Denmark, I've been out to Denmark. Denmark was mental, man. They love it out there. I just got back from Finland, and Finland was nuts as well, man. Like everywhere I've been, it's just been nuts. I can't believe it, because like obviously I'm sitting at home like making tunes and like mixing or doing whatever, but when you go abroad, you're like, "Wow, what is going on here? There's all these people like loving it and stuff, and it's quality, man." So like I'm just loving it at the moment. It's wicked. The internet has been a massive boost for the scene. Like, I mean, people are downloading mixes off of Bare Files, like in their hundreds every week. Like, you just see like all these like people download it, goes like from 1 week it's 200, then up to like 1,000, then up to 3,000. It's mad. Like, I think the internet's been a really good thing for building up the amount of people who get to listen to the sound now, because some people can't listen to Rinse FM in their car or in their bedroom. So the internet has given people from all over the world a chance to listen to the music and hear what people are doing over here in our country and other countries as well. With my production at the moment, my DJing has kind of taken over from my production a lot recently. I haven't had a lot of time to make tunes because, I mean, I've been like running about here, there and everywhere to loads of different countries and like to do, playing like in wherever forward, these sort of places all around London and everything. So for me, because I'm working as well 9 to 5, it's been hard because I've got a lot of stuff on the go, but I'm still making tunes. There's a few, but I'm trying to sort of refine my sound at the moment, because before I was making tunes and I was bringing them down here, innit, Jay, and Jay was saving my life with the mix downs. I'll do a mix downs, he'd come down here and save my life, I swear, Dan. So like basically at the moment I'm learning, trying to learn about frequencies a lot more, because before I'd bang a tune together and the idea would be there, but the mix down's really important, and that's what I think a lot of people need to focus on, is mix down. With my production, that's why I'm trying to take it to the next level, like improve it and learn from all the guys like Benny and Skream and all the guys who are making wicked tunes, and listening to what Jay's got to say, and like actually learning from these guys, do you know what I mean? Because they're the dons, mate, do you know what I mean? And what they're doing, they're the dons, and you need to take influence from people. You can't like sort of expect to like sit in your room with all your doors and all your windows shut and not listen to anything else is going on, and then take it there. Well, I mean, some people may be, but like not for me. I always take influence from people who I know are like the dons of what they're doing, and that's what I'm trying to do at the moment, so it's all good. I've had a few releases though, it's been nice, hasn't it? Funniest things that happened to me through my sets, I don't know really, like I've done like a million and one stupid clumsy things before. One of the classic ones where I think every DJ has done this once, yeah, is like go to like you're doing whatever you're doing and someone's talking to you and you're like yeah, and you go to pick up the record to get the next record, and you pick up the record on the wrong deck, and then all this music goes. Yeah.
I've done that.
Jay's done it.
I've done that.
We've all done it, mate. That's the standard one. The other thing I quite like is shots while I'm on the decks. That's quite alright. Like Finland, big up the Finland gang here. Because when I was out there, every 5 minutes I looked up, there was a shot in my face, and it was like, yeah, son, yeah, son. I said, I'm trying to do something. They're like, do it. And I said, I'm trying to do something. Do you know what I mean? I'm trying to mix in the middle of a mix with a fucking shot of Zambuca in my face. So then it was just like, bosh, bosh, bosh. And by the end of the set, mate, I was wasted, mate. Back in the day, yeah, I used to be a killer for getting wasted on a set. Now, no way, mate, I'm like good for that. Like now there's loads of people there and they're like coming to see. Like, the worst thing to do is get wasted on a set. So now I'm like, Mr. Yeah, right? Couple of Cokes. Yeah, trying to be professional, man, because you can't be all over the shop, man. Look, people, kids don't come to raves to watch someone like matched out of their face, like dribbling all of that over the decks, like clanging it up all over the shop, mate. People don't want to see that, so it's all about being professional. So, yeah, back in the day was probably the funny days, but we ain't going to talk too much about that anyway. Yeah, this is N-Type, and I'm signing off now. You've been watching Dubfiles. Big up.
Boy, Slaughter Mob is like, it's four members of Slaughter Mob, yeah. You got myself, like Vicious MC, you got like Bandit.
Hello.
Yeah, and then you got like another member, Darren, yeah, like which is like Vicious MC, Dangerous MC, yeah. Then you got Q Nice, yeah, which is the other DJ, yeah. So like we all kind of come together like through the garage scene, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
So like it was like we kind of like we had the same kind of taste in music. You like the more dubby kind of underground side of it, yeah? It's like
non-vocal.
Not too pretty. None of that Chocolate Boy stuff, you get what I'm saying? Like, just a bit, you know what I mean? All the ones that they were playing in the club, we normally wouldn't really have played them, you know what I'm saying? And it kind of, it tell because we weren't getting the bookings then either because no one were really into that, you know what I'm saying? But then, luckily, Forward came along, you know what I'm saying? Like, and then we found that there was other people like ourselves who like that same kind of underground kind of stuff, you get what I'm saying? So like, we kind of fell into to place by that really, you get me? Like, we've been together since what?
10 years now.
Well, over that now.
Unfortunately.
Over that now, mate. You're going to sack you soon, isn't it?
No, it's about 10 years, yeah. Because I think we was on, is it Chicago? Yeah, I was about 19, so that's about 10
Chicago,
years.
Chicago, then it was like Mission. Yeah. We've done a little underground.
The good old days,
what do you call it? The pirate radio station circuit kind of thing, you know what I'm saying? Like, which everyone was doing back then kind of thing, and then like, after that kind of phased out and the garage scene kind of phased out, we was left with like a music that had no name kind of, which everyone who was in it back then would tell you, like, it never really had no name kind of thing. And like, boy, eventually this dubstep terminology kept on coming out from somewhere, and like certain people liked the name, some people didn't like the name, but luckily it stuck, and boy, the music that we was told we was making is dubstep music, simple thing.
The first release that we probably with dubstep sort of thing was JJ Lewis's N19, and that was when we first started working with
N-Double,
and that was about 99.
That's when we first started to be right.
And that was when it was. So that was when we were sort of our influences then were sort of like LB and Steve Gurley and
Zed Byers.
So we was trying to sort of go down that road, but obviously ours wasn't sort of like as polished and as good as their stuff.
Yeah, because we were just starting out.
But it still had the same sort of vibe to it. Do you know what I mean? But that sort of like went under the radar because it was a white and. It's still sold, isn't it? It's sold out or whatever, but people didn't really know sort of
who kind of done
what it was, or do you know what I mean, or who it was about or whatever. So then after that, we did that Pink Panther thing.
Yeah, we did that. Well, we did that didn't come out, didn't it?
Yeah, it did. Yeah.
On whose
label? JJ Lewis put that.
Oh yeah, on N19 again. Yeah.
So then after that, I think it was probably the Soldier thing.
It was the Soldier.
Because for a while, it was a bit of a thing of
just making the beats and playing them. We never really had no idea to be people.
And maybe just getting a sound and more polishing it. So like the Soldier thing was four tracks that were made more over a length of time, rather than, you know, like sometimes you sort of cut the sessions and it's put together and it's there. This was sort of like over a period of months, just sort of coming back to it and adding little bits and getting it sort of like to how it ended up coming out. So there was a Dub Weapon, Zombie, Thriller Funk, and Sada. Yeah. So basically the Reflex project came about by the guys at Reflex Records was Grant.
Apex Twins, isn't it?
Grant. Grant got sent a copy from Neil, I think. And I think he wanted to sign the Soldier thing. He wanted to put that out. Yeah. But they obviously weren't really up for that. So he said, well, they'd been coming down to Forward and they were into, you know, stuff that they'd put out previously and stuff like that. So they said, like, well, why don't we, you know, try and do this sort of like compilation thing? So they said, okay, what we'll do is we'll work with the last three artists that you've had on Soldier, which was us, Plastician and Mark One.
Yeah.
So that's sort of how that came about. They said, like, right, let's do this then. So they sort of asked us to submit tracks to them along with Mark One and Plastician, and that's how it got together.
That was definitely the first kind of bringing it out from underneath kind of thing. Definitely helped to bring it out from underneath.
Yeah, loads of people that just didn't have a clue about it, suddenly, what is this? Mm-hmm. You know,
and still to this day, kind of some people got a bit confused because obviously the title was called Grime, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. But really, it was dubstep music. I was saying, but like, it was that's how the music goes.
But I think, see, back then. There was still this thing of the name.
Yeah, what is the name?
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think from Grant's perspective, he wanted dubstep to go under the grime banner because it was instrumental music like grime. Do you know what I mean? So I think that's what his angle was. You know, he wanted dubstep maybe not to have its name dubstep. It would be. I mean, if he'd have had his way, it might have been called grime now. Do you know what I mean? Do you know what I mean? I personally don't think it could have.
I don't either, because I think it is to me, when I listen to Grime, it is a total different type of music. Like, there might have been back then a certain elements, like, for where, because even they were starting out then, you know what I'm saying? So there might have been certain elements that we all, and a lot of the Grime boys come out of the garage scene as well. So there were certain elements that we all would have that we liked, to get what I'm saying? But with the essence of it really is Grime, to me personally, doesn't necessarily have to have a deep bass, you get what I'm saying? Because you've always got the rapper or the spitter doing his thing on top, yeah? And he is as much as part of it as the beat is, you get what I'm saying? Where with dubstep, 99% of the time, it is just the music only, you know what I'm saying? So in order to keep that interesting, you need to have a lot more changes and things in there. You can't just have a little repetitive element, yeah? You'll have the little noises and the sounds coming in and out, you get what I'm saying? To break it up a beat, you get what I'm saying? Break up the monotony. Thriller Funk, that was the one. That was kind of like, apart from Forward, that was kind of like the first, to me, to my knowledge, it was kind of like the first, like, other dubstep dance that you could go to,
That's
really.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So what we tried to do was, we was getting all this great music off, like, Benga, Skream, you know, well, loads of people in it that weren't really getting any bookings down at Forward.
All them guys, like, we even had them out there doing their thing. That was before they was even really known.
We're thinking to ourselves, you know, how come these guys aren't
Yeah, because their beats are like...
Because they're making some dirty, sick tunes, you know what I mean? So it's like, right, F it, let's do it. So we'd get these guys coming to play down there, do you know what I mean? And let other people see what they can do sort of thing.
Rather than the same old, you know what I mean?
Yeah, because for a scene to grow, you need to have a bit of variety in there. You can't just have one little small group of people doing the whole thing, because it's just not going to really...
That's not a scene really, is it?
No. What happened was, we started, the first one was sort of like towards the summer, and then they left it for a few months, and then they gave us another date in December, and it was just before Christmas, and that night went off, it was just rammed. But then going into the new year, they changed the day on us, and I think we sort of rushed into it a bit too much and didn't give it the time that it needed to kickstart a night in a new year, do you know what I mean? So the January one, which I think we should have really skipped, we did, and it wasn't very busy. So then by then the promoter or the owner of the night is thinking, oh, I'm not so sure about this now, you know? So then
remember, the owner of the club,
the February one was a bit getting better again. It was a bit better than the January one, but it wasn't too hot again, do you know what I mean? But by then, kind of the damage had been done, you know? So he basically said, right, you know, I don't think it's going to work. We'll try this again in another few months' time, you know? Because the music was such a new genre anyway, he himself wasn't sure how it was going to go, you know? So he was a bit, you know...
He wasn't ready to think, really.
Yeah, exactly. Which is funny, because some of their Thursday nights are never great anyway, no matter what music you play.
Yeah, it is a Thursday. To me, making music, because we're like, most of us are all self-taught kind of thing, like, so you're always, to me, making music is a learning thing all the time. You always learn it. When you bring out a new piece of software or a new plugin, you need to learn how to use it. So to me, we've just learned, we've got a lot more knowledge of the music game, the dubstep scene, like, what to me, what kind of works and what really don't work. You know what I mean? Like those kind of things there. We've got much more knowledge now, I think, than we had back then. You know what I mean? Back then it was just more of like, yeah, I just want to build tunes, you know what I'm saying? But now I have a focus when I'm building my tunes, you know what I'm saying? Like I'll build a tune. If I want to build a tune that has a certain sound to it, I can do that. Where back then, I'll just build a tune, yeah? And whatever sound it had, you get what I'm saying? But now we build with a focus kind of thing, you know what I'm saying? And like the scene in itself, I think it's good that you've got people from all over and bringing their take on it, you know what I'm saying? Because you'll hear people like from like, Bristol making their things, you know what I'm saying? And their ones don't sound like ours down there, you know what I'm saying? So it's not like they're trying to copy, they're making their own dubstep with their own signature on it, which to me is a good thing for a scene, really.
I've learned how to do production and make tracks, arrange tracks, twiddle bass lines. Now I've started a label, do you know what I mean? So over the years, you sort of like want to take in fresh things and learn new things, start trying to do nights and, do you know what I mean, get the right people down at the nights and the right sort of sound system in there and all that. So that is something that I've done over the years, that where it's changed, you know, from starting as a sort of pirate radio DJ to now trying to sort of like run a few.
You hit the nail on the head, especially the sound system thing. That was like, in the beginning, obviously you want to, any rave you want to have a nice system, but it wasn't the main focus kind of thing. But now, in a dubstep, to have a dubstep bent dance, you have to have a decent enough system in there, otherwise they walk, yeah? Because remember, everyone's producing a lot of low-end basses, and if those speakers can't really produce those basses, you ain't hearing nothing, you know what I mean? Hearing treble, you get me? That's a thing that's changed a lot. Back in the day, people was happy to just rave anywhere, yeah? Now, your system shoddy, it ain't working, you get me?
Halo Beats is one of the labels, it's six release is going to be him coming out in the next couple of weeks. Then we've got another label starting up, which is
the Slugs in the Mud.
The first release of that is hopefully going to be out in the next couple of months as well. So like, yeah, there's a couple of labels, but
and we've got lots of bits like just on many different people's labels. You've got like Hot Flush, we're on
Skream. Label Sluts.
Really and truly, like the usual equipment, like you just got your little, either it's PC or it's a Mac, you get me, one of the other, you know what I'm saying, yeah? And boy, not mainly in like software based, like we don't really deal in a lot of outboard, you know what I'm saying? I'm not saying it ain't good, but I'm just saying for us personally, the software based studio is the way we like to do things, you know what I'm saying? All the plugins, all that usual stuff, where you might have a few artists who only deal in the old school way of doing things, like maybe, like because we built tunes with LB and them, and he likes to use the outboard stuff, he likes to use the little synthesizer rather than the software synth, you know what I'm saying? He likes to use maybe a sampler rather than the software sampler, you know what I'm saying? But it's all down really to me, like whatever you can use it or whatever you think it sounds good. Because if you don't like the software ones, then you ain't gonna really build a good tune. If you like the outboard shits, then we're like, you're all good. We use just straightly like the Mac and like keyboard, simple mixing there, so you have your simple. It's a very small system, you don't really need too much.
Reason, you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, I use Reason, yeah, but what I'm saying is, we use Reason and Logic.
Yeah.
Simple things, so.
Yeah.
I mean, that's all it is, that's all you need. Because certain people will just say to you, you only need Reason. Yeah, you know, like, simple things.
Well, there is a lot of people that are just using Reason or Fruity Loops, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? A few years ago, I had a bit of a stigma. It's like, oh, you can't make decent tunes on it. But I've changed my tune a lot over the last couple of years. Since I've heard, you know, and then heard what it's been made on, I'm like, what, you know? So now I don't say anything. As long as you're using it properly and it's coming out with the it's, you know, everything's sounding right.
The end result.
Do you know what I mean? It doesn't really matter what you're making it on, does it?
Yeah, straight.
But I mean, there was a lot of that though, sort of elitist
snobbery.
Yeah, you know? Snobbery of like, oh, well, I use Cubase or Logic, and if you're using this, it's not a real music program, you know. But I mean, over the last couple of years, that sort of argument's just gone right
out the window. Yeah, because all those same people that are complaining about it, they're still, their tunes ain't selling in the shop. You know what I'm saying? So really and truly, as long as you just make your bits, that's the main thing. I don't care what you use. You
can't even do an intro.
Exactly. You know what I mean? Went to college, studied, went to uni, everything, you hit me like, but still can't do shit.
I've heard stories about that.
What's the point?
People going out and spending $30,000 on it and they can't even,
Know. My main production tip would be, which I know is the mistake that I used to make, would be like, pushing, like when you're doing your levels, and that levels is the main thing. Forget all the mastering and the mixing down, because if you don't know what you're doing, you might just mash up what you're dealing with, yeah? So to me, the main thing is your levels, yeah? Everything needs to be low, yeah? You don't want no peaking nowhere, yeah? If you want it to get fatter, the man in the master that does the mastering, he can make it fat for you, yeah? Simple things. When you're giving out your tunes, give them out flat. Forget all the mastering and trying to do things you don't know. If you know what you're doing, that's fair enough, yeah? But if you don't know what you're doing, keep it simple. Everything you do, keep it simple. Your basses, keep them simple. Your beats, keep them simple. Not simple as in like some plinky plonky element, but I mean, don't try to run before you can walk. You know what I'm saying? So, you know what I mean?
I've also found as well, it's good to go into the studio with some sort of idea or plan of what you're going to do, rather than sort of
sit there,
you know, oh, we'll try this. No, we'll try this. You know, because you could be there for hours, just wasting time, and at the end of it, you're not really coming up with anything because you're just getting frustrated
that it ain't working.
The whole session just becomes a whole waste of time. Then, do you know what I mean? So if you go, especially like me getting a bit old now as well, it's not really about just sitting in there and just sort of messing about, innit? Do you know what I mean?
As I said, we got to focus now.
Sort of like, right, I thought of this. Do you know what I mean? I've got this in my head. Let's put it down. Do you know what I mean? So yeah, that's something that I would say.
We're Slaughter Mob, and you're watching Dubfiles, yeah.
Hello, I'm Pinch, I'm from Bristol. I'm representing Dubstep here. Well, I've got a few things going on. I mean, I run a label called Tectonic, another one called Earwax, and I do nights here. I've got a monthly called Dubloaded, and a biannual dance called Subloaded. The difference between the two is Subloaded, it's bigger dance, bigger rave, big lineups. It's a bit of a familiar tale, but boredom of drum and bass and a lot of things kind of just weren't hitting the mark, and went down to Forward one night 3 years ago. I saw Code 9 play and it just took me away, you know, and didn't look back after that. Started a night up within about 2 months of that, had things running and people coming up here and playing, Loafer, Cyrus, and you know, Vexed, people like that. And just built on that, started Subloaded with a guy called Blazy, who come in from a grime angle, and just together we put together Subloaded, and the Dubloaded became the monthly for the W stuff. Yeah, Tectonic started spring 2005, and started off with collaboration I did with Breaks producer called 30 Hertz, and really, you know, I just wanted to kind of get involved. My own production was early days at that point, and I mean, it was just not sounding crisp, and so I got into the studio with a guy I knew how to push the buttons, and we came out with a 12, and then built on there and got a lot of things I had on dub plate from people, and just found a happy home on Tectonic sort of thing. So yeah, and this year has really stepped up for the label. We've done a series of 10-inch releases and just released a CD, double CD, and hopefully that's going to expand the market and take it outside of just, you know, record shops and hopefully into people's iPods and different sort of thing. The double CD is called Tectonic Plates, and it's got it's two CDs. One's mixed, and one's unmixed, and the unmixed is just kind of label highlights, and then the mixed one's got sort of, you know, some extra dub plates in there. But it's a lot of big tunes on there: Mystics, Loafer, Skream, all the big hitters. I mean, I liked the idea for the name of Tectonic. Kind of came from, you know, the idea of earthquake bass and tectonic plates shifting and plates and vinyls, and it's just, I'm a sucker for a pun, so it kind of melted into that. That's the concept behind it, really. But yeah, you know, next year looking to do artist albums, random trio album, and try and step it up, and, you know, different thing from just putting out 12s and 10 inches and things like that. Just kind of hope it keeps it interesting, you know. My production, I mean, I think it's got kind of quite a sort of techno influence in a way. It's very minimal and progressive, sort of some soundscapes and stuff. And I don't know, it's difficult to say, really. It's just what comes out of my computer when I've finished pushing the mouse button, you know. But yeah, I mean, I've got a couple of remixes I've done for some people that will be coming out, and I'm working towards building an album for myself. I've got a really, my studio set up, if you call it a studio, it's just a computer. I've got some monitors now, which has made a big difference, and I just run Fruity Loops, some VSTs and some EQs, and it's just all I use, really. It's kind of simple setup. I've got to know it, though, and I think it's important that you know what you're using, and I think I will probably step up in the next year or so, try and get my head around Logic or Cubase or something, but at the moment it's all just Fruity for me. I mean, I think the Waves plugins are really good. They're, you know, you've got some really good EQs and compressors on there. I think that's good for making things sound tighter. I mean, synth-wise, I mean, a lot of people, myself included, use Albino, and there's lots of other ones as well. My influences are, I like a lot of things. I mean, I was really into jungle. I used to DJ jungle and drum and bass, and as I say, I got bored of it after a while, and I actually started picking up on a lot of minimal techno and electronica, and I really got into Rhythm and Sound and Basic Channel and the Berlin outfit that have done some just amazing stuff, really. And yeah, I mean, I in all honesty, I'd say take a lot of inspiration from my peers in the scene. I think people like Skream and Loafer and Mystics, Vexed, the things that they're doing, I find constantly inspiring. Code 9, all of them, you know, it's a real kind of constant surprises from them lot, you know. Until this year, no, I'd never really played abroad. I played in Berlin twice this year, and Budapest. Played out in the States, did a date in Los Angeles and then San Francisco, and that's with distance I went out. I'm playing in Belgium next weekend and Finland just before Christmas. So you've got a few things coming up. Well, I think, you know, a lot of genres have kind of, they've run their course in a way. Not that people can't make good music in drum and bass or good music in house, and these are genres like hip hop, they're going to go on for years, but you're not going to get any more surprises. And I think the thing is with dubstep, it's just kind of, it's got that thirst for something different that people relate to. I mean, I think it's gone all around the world really quickly, mainly because of the internet, and then, you know, it's a lot easier to kind of just pick up on this stuff now. I mean, you've got all these sites where you can download the mixes from Rinse and all these kind of things. It's really easy to get your head around what's going on in London because of the internet and because of all the kind of, you know, the doors of communication, MSN, AIM, all these kind of things. It's really easy to get in touch with people and find out, and I think that's why it's really blown up so quickly. I like to think that Bristol's a second home. I'm not the one who said it, other people have said it, and I've got on really well with all the people in the scene, and I've found it a real blessing to kind of work with them, and you know, everyone's solid as gold, you know. And yeah, I'd like to think that it's found a home here, and you know, look on flyers now, and you know, there's lots of mixed eclectic nights, and they've got dubstep in it, and you know, it wouldn't have happened a few years ago. So yeah, I think it's found a comfortable home here. Yeah, there was some good producers coming through. I mean, obviously you've got the Hench crew with Headhunter and White Boy and Commoner's Muck and Wedge, and you've got the one I've really got my eye on at the moment. I think's got some really wicked music. It's Joker. He's kind of come from a grime background, but his stuff is original. It's fresh. He's young as well. I think he's only 17 still. But he's making really well produced music. Never heard anything like before. I think he's gonna be big next year, yeah. I know Plastician's got his eye on a couple of things for release, Terror Rhythm, and you know, I've got an EP lined up as well for Earwax. Yeah, I think he's gonna impress some people next year. It's a funny thing because I think the way through for DJs is to be a producer, and the way it works with, it's not just dubstep, but especially in dubstep, it's all about who's holding dubs. And if you haven't got something different in your bag, then it's going to be hard to get through. So you've got to really, you know, if you're a DJ, I'd say try and put some effort into doing something different, you know, shaping the sound, maybe how you mix it up and what you use. You just got to come with your own angle, basically. As a producer, I mean, you just write what sounds right to you and don't worry about what other people think until, I mean, you need to get feedback off people. I don't mean don't worry at all about what people think, but really you've got to learn to believe in what you're doing yourself. And it doesn't matter what programs you use, it doesn't matter how you do it, you know, you can make good music if you've got a good ear. This is Pinch from Bristol, you're locked into Dubfiles.
What's going on? This is Caspa and you're locked into Dubfiles. A little bit about Caspa. Been making beats under Caspa for probably about two and a half years now. Had various releases on Tempa, my own labels, just Sub Soldiers and Dub Police. Done a remix on Argon, done a CD on Fabric. Who else have I done stuff? Pitch Black, Search and Destroy's label. Remix of Wonder's label, Wonderland. Quite a few good things I'm proud of, actually. This is the thing, I don't like to... If you are someone else, most definitely, dare say that Casper's got a style. But I don't sit out and sort of try to make one style of music. I've got a lot of stuff that I make, like, different styles. Do you know what I mean? I don't want to say one style. But I'm known, probably, if you ask someone else, I'm probably known for making, like, probably dance floor stuff. Do you know what I mean? Like full-on party sort of dubstep, like proper in your face, wobbles. Do you know what I mean? But I make a lot of different stuff, really. Like, if you listen to the Avid Volume 2, that sums up who I'm about right now. Four different tracks from myself, and it's just, that is me right now on Sub Soldiers, the new LP. Every single track is what I'm about, so. But I don't like to say I'm just make one type of dubstep. I just make it all. I love it all, do you know what I mean? Completely love it all. I like the smooth with the dance floor, with the easy listening stuff, whatever. What got me into dubstep is probably the progression from back in the day when I was going down forward and stuff. And I started DJing the Quietstorm, playing like the breaksteppy stuff. And then just moved on with the times onto the dubstep, like dubstep sound, like the halftime sound. I've got a label called Storming, Dub Police, Sub Soldiers. So they're all my labels, so pretty much, I just love the way the scene's diverse, and so I got into it pretty much by just, from back in the day, just following it. I progressed from sort of garage, I suppose. Do you know what I mean? It progressed from garage all the way up to where it is now. But everyone's just got their own influences on it. I'm a DJ, that's what I do. I only started making beats so I could play my own. I could go and cut plates because no one would give me change. No one would give me tunes. I was like, fuck these lot, I'm going to go and just make my own tunes. You know what I mean? And cut them. So I'm definitely a DJ first and then producer second. But lately I've been just producing when I DJ, I suppose. But that's all good. It goes round and roundabouts, doesn't it, I suppose? Do you know what I mean? Most definitely. Influences come from all kinds of things, really. I'd say pretty much a lot of my stuff comes from British culture and stuff. I love watching British films and comedy, British comedy as well, like Only Fools and Horses. Some of us do have them. On the Buses, all the Carry On films, I love all that stuff. So I try and have a bit of fun with what I do, do you know what I mean? It's just me, it's just who I am. Apart from that side of things, I listen to a lot of drum and bass. I like drum and bass, all kinds of drum and bass. Then I've sort of grown up listening to, my brother was big time into hip hop, like early Wu-Tang, Mobb Deep, Mos Def, Talib Kweli, Gangsta, all that stuff, Common. My dad's a punk, so he was into the punk and everything on that side of things. Do you know what I mean? So I've had literally influences from everywhere, do you know what I mean? And all the, when I was younger, I used to hang out with older boys, they was all into hardcore and jungle. So pretty much I've got like a head full of sort of influences and stuff, and my own influences from what I like I just told you about the British culture and stuff. So it pretty much comes from everywhere, and whatever comes out, comes out. Some tunes you can hear different types of influences, do you know what I mean? It's quite madness really to actually sit there and, or go into a shop and see it, Fabric CD. Because you look at like down the aisle and you see like Andy C and Hype, Groove Rider and Caspa and Rusko, and you're kind of like, do you know what I mean? But it come about kind of weird really. The actual CD was meant to be this group called Justice. If you search on it on Justice side, they're pretty massive anyway. And it's meant to be their CD, and they basically gave the CD in. And to be polite, Fabric just said, I don't think we're gonna put this out. So they pretty much had a time period that they wanted to put, because they wanted something fresh, do you know what I mean? Because the last few CDs they've liked, but they said that it hasn't been as fresh, do you know what I mean? So they just pretty much said, right, we've been working with them for a while through our publishing, me and Rusko, and working with the artists, and we played a few times at the club, and they loved what we were doing. And they were kind of like, man, this is like, your stuff is so like, out there. So, and it come about that time when they said no to the Justice CD. And they were kind of like, well, look, guys, they just literally built me up. I was thinking it was on a Tuesday or something, or a Wednesday. And just said, all right, what's going on? This is blah, blah from Fabric. I was like, cool, cool, cool. It was Matt at Fabric. Do you want to mix a Fabric Live CD? And I kind of thought he was like joking first of all. I was like, yeah, when? And he was like, can you hand it in on Monday? And I was kind of like, all right, of course. You're not going to say no, do you know what I mean? Kwan said, yeah, cool, alright then. Hand it in Monday. Kind of got off the phone and was kind of like, did I just hear what he said? Do you know what I mean? The Fabric Live CD, I was like, and it kind of all went through in my head, all the people that done the Fabric Live, John Peel, all them people, like I just said. And you're kind of like, fuck, that's serious, man. Called Rusko up, he was like, yeah, I just had the same sort of feeling. So we played out in Sheffield on Saturday. Come back from Sheffield. Well, that was our first gig we'd done together in ages, and we tore it to pieces, man. And then in the car on the way back down, we kind of said, right, write your list of tunes that you want. I pulled over, I've written my list of tunes that I wanted on there. Put the two things together. Called Sanj, the guy who's the engineer at Fabric, said, can we come down Monday and mix it in the club? Because we've got nowhere to mix it. And my deck's at anywhere, do you know what I mean? Mixer's broke, so we had to do it somewhere. So we said, let's do it in a club. It's like, cool. Went down there, room 3, empty. Had 2 hours to mix it, because the guy had to go home. So if we messed up, it's pretty much whatever we'd done in the 2 hours, it had to be done. Mixed the CD. That was on a Monday. Tuesday, mastered it. Wednesday, it's promoed. Bang. So, yeah. And then after all that, when it finally come out and I see the packaging, I was kind of like, that was funny how that just come about, do you know what I mean? But I'm pretty much, I'm very proud of it, do you know what I mean? To say that's what it's up there, on the wall, do you know what I mean? But I'm pretty proud of it to say I've done a Fabric CD, man, do you know what I mean? So if all else fails, and I go down the shitter now, at least I got a Fabric CD. Like, since that's happened, a lot of things have just come off it, and it's just, it's gone crazy. It's it's gone really mad and that. And we got a lot of stick for it as well. Do you know what I mean? Doing the CD and it was like, oh, you haven't put these tunes on there. Or why aren't them tunes on there? And these, and it's like, little do you know that people wouldn't let us put certain tunes on there. But you don't know that. And you don't need to know that, do you know what I mean? And it ain't a, now here comes Dubstep 45 Woolworths compilation. It's not that, it's a Caspa and Rusko live, that's why it's Fabric live, in and like our set, and we just played our set, we played at the club, we played out probably at Sheffield. But it's just what we do. So you have a, it's Marmite, I suppose. You love it or you hate it, or you dabble in it. This year and the last year, I pretty much played so many countries. So the best place I've probably played in abroad, yeah, is, one that sticks out in my mind by far, is probably Pure Filth in LA, downtown LA. That was kind of mad. LA, you was in LA and you're thinking, I don't know what this is gonna be like. It was crazy. Crazy system, crazy people. Right. They threw me off the decks because they had to close the club, but there's people shouting more. That was a big gig, I really enjoyed that. But there's loads of places I've enjoyed. I played in Israel, which is amazing and weird. Just to say, oh, dubstep in Israel, but it was nuts. People knew the tunes. Do you know what I mean? Australia, New Zealand, Dublin was funny as well. Like all these places you don't think people even know what dubstep is. You're completely wrong. It's kind of ignorant in a way. They know what's going on. Because you forget how powerful the internet is, do you know what I mean? They can just click on your MySpace and see what your new tune is or where you're playing or who your friend is and they can listen to their tunes. So pretty much they can find out what you're about within half an hour. And you forget that, do you know what I mean? So when you go into these countries, you're like, oh, I don't know what this tune is. Someone comes up to you, oh, have you got this tune? You're like, how the hell do you know about that? I only made that like a week ago. You're like, oh man, oh, you know what I mean? Internet. You're like, shit. So yeah, I played loads of places, man. But one that sticks out probably is LA. Label-wise, I run a label called, the labels that I run, Storming Productions, Dub Police, and Sub Soldiers. The artists I've worked with on Storming, Search and Destroy, Dub Child, Toasty Boy, Narrows, Morph, Oris J, Mark 1, Bogeyman, Distance, Rezzo, and then Dub Police, Elwiz, N-Type, Rusko, The Others, Units, Orion, Dub Wolf. Oh, there's loads, man. So in the camp that I'm working with, I've built, there's a lot of talent and there's a lot of artists. And then Soul Soldiers is pretty much just me and Rusko putting the tunes out. So there's a lot of people I'm still working with. Storming, sort of, the sound is not really the sound that's going on at the moment, but it still sells, but it's not as popular. So I'm always going to do that and I still love that. Do you know what I mean? Dub Police has always been a platform for new artists to bring through what I think music's quality. Do you know what I mean? And that's always worked. And that's pretty much, you know, it's always worked real nice, like N-Type being on there, having his first release, and Rusko, and Elwiz, and all them boys now are pretty much doing good things. So there's a lot going on within the camp, and there's a lot of artists, and there's a lot of tunes to play, so I'm always down to cutting and playing the new stuff out. And it's going really well, man. It's going really well. I'm happy, like, sales are really good. Like, I'm getting a lot of good feedback from everyone and all the artists. It's kind of like what I've built, what I've always wanted to build, is like a family unit. And that's what it kind of feels like now. And it's quite nice, it's comfortable, like, almost best pals with Rusko, do you know what I mean? And he's doing some amazing stuff at the moment. And everyone on the label is really tight, and we're just pushing each other, and it's just growing and growing and growing. It's grown so much over a year, it's been madness. But I think there's so much more potential that it has. So it's going really well, man. Yeah, just moved in, man, and it's pretty simple setup. Bit of Reason, bit of Cubase, bit of Acid Pro. Yeah, pair of Fostics, so I think they're sort of like the best monitors you can get in the price range, and they've done me good. I really like them, so I've got used to them. MIDI keyboard, got a bass line on there at the moment, so it's pretty simple, but I think it doesn't matter what you use, it's how you use it and how you manipulate anything. Do you know what I mean? You could have stacks and stacks of hardware, like the old school boys did, samplers and synths and whatnot. That, if that's how you work, that's how you work. But this is all I need, a little MIDI keyboard, my few programs and a pair of £300 monitors, and pretty much that's it, and my PC. So it's a real simple setup, but for me it's always worked, and do you know what I mean? Whatever works. How I normally start a tune would be around maybe a sample or something. Like this tune I'm starting now, it's all right, it needs a lot of work, but I found this sample.
In actuality, we are nothing more than a pair of street musicians. Those tunes will take hold of your soul and then slowly break your heart.
So I heard that sample when I was kind of like, all right, what can I build around that? So I thought something come in, be quite dark and deep, do you know what I mean? So that's what I normally do. I normally go for a sample of, because I'm quite sample orientated, do you know what I mean? Grab that and I'll build something around that. Build a beat and then build a bass line and then roll with that. But then sometimes it's the complete opposite. I'll just start with literally kick and snare. And just go boom, 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 boom. Sometimes things just probably just roll and you can finish a tune, honestly, like if you're firing 2 hours, or some tunes could take you a week to finish because you don't know where you want to take it. But I suppose it's what mood you're interested in. So yeah, I started this tune around a sample and then it pretty much just drops up here.
We are nothing more than a pair of street musicians.
You probably can't need a sub on that, but it's proper subby. So yeah, it depends. I normally work around samples, but it can literally be anything. I suppose whatever you're inspired by. But like I said to you before, I'm pretty inspired by, watch loads of films. Do you know what I mean? Loads of, a lot of British films as well. That's why I've got a lot of swearing in my tunes. I tend to watch a lot of British films that got a lot of swearing in.
My name is Benga from South London, 21 years old. I make dubstep music, also DJ, and you're watching Dubfiles. Go on. Dubstep. It's weird really because I'm not one of them to be on like a genre or say, oh, my music's this or that, but then dubstep's more the reference to instrumental music rather than dubstep as in dub like reggae. But then I think people think that's what it is, but it's not even that. Steps really from like the two-step where it come from. My music's still kind of two-step. I have a half-step drum, like kick and snare, but my music's really two-step. Like my hats and my percussion, bass lines are still two-step. It's my mix. But Benga the producer, always. It's more, I'm not saying I don't like DJing or DJing's not a good thing or whatever, but producing's what I enjoy. I like the point where it gets to where I'm making a song and I get out everything that's in my head sort of thing, and then when it all comes together, it's not like saying, oh, when I'm DJing I'm mixing the record and I don't get a buzz or nothing, but it's always just been production for me. DJing just came, it's like chicken or the egg. When I first started making music, I was 12 years old, and I was DJing at first, so it was like, I think I went to see Hatcha play, or maybe I heard a set, and none of the songs I heard, I could buy. So I was like, rah, what's the next way to do this? Start making my own tunes, to play my own song sort of thing. And then, weren't too long after that, I started using the PlayStation. So like, Music 2000 or Music, I think it was called. And I was coming up with the basic tunes, but you've got to start somewhere, innit? And then I met Arthur and John and then moved on from there really. And they started telling me, oh, this is the sound you need to stick to, this your distinctive, if you keep doing this, you stay, this sound will evolve or whatever. So, like mentors to me, yeah. Back then I was listening to like Wookiee, LB and Benny Hill Artworks. So it was like we listened to them, but we couldn't make what they made, sort of thing. It wasn't really like advanced at producing, so we we just kept on banging away at beats and it just sounded like whatever. It didn't sound like what they was making, but to us it was like, we're making that sort of sound. But that's how it really came about, because to us we saw it differently to everyone else. And then Judgment came out of that, really. Like, my style's changed because I progressed production-wise more so, but then I couldn't really say there's like a massive difference. Like, there's not, the only thing that's changed in my structure is like my kick and snare, like just the halftime kick and snare. But then there's no changes in like, my sound has dramatically changed. I'm still all about bassline and rolling beats. But then the only thing that I can say I've progressed on is like using the piano, keyboard and shit, and production, like putting engineering and stuff. Nothing else than myself. It's a funny little story, to be fair. Like, we linked up at Big Apple. Skream met my brother, and he was like, yeah, I make beats. And he was, and my brother was like, yeah, so does my little brother. And my brother just gave him my number. Like, that's not something that happens these days, isn't it? Like, you don't just say, oh, yeah, I make beats, you make beats, yeah, here's my number. We get together sometime. It's not like a date, is it? So, boy, he rung me. And then we just said, yeah, let me hear your tunes. And he played his tunes down the phone to me. And I'll be like, yeah, I'll play my tunes down the phone to him. And we didn't really make a decision on who's the best. But we battled, didn't it? Because it was like that sort of, oh, we got to be there. He's got to be the best, or I got to be the best. But it wasn't like anything unhealthy. It was all healthy because it helps us progress quickly. I think if he wasn't there, I wouldn't be at this stage now, no way, because I wouldn't be making tunes as much as I did, because obviously I liked making music, but I think that was part of the hunger. Him being there and making me think, oh, his tune's gonna blow up and mine won't if I don't make the next bigger one. Sorry about this. I don't do this all the time. Don't hang up my phone all the time, I promise. I made a lot of other types of music, and I've done well in other types of music, but it's more, the tempo's always suited me, because I used to listen to drum and bass a lot and like happy hardcore and stuff. But then I got into garage because it was the tempo. But then I liked the drum and bass because of how dark it was and stuff. So dubstep for me is just everything that I liked, and I can bring it into my music. It's the right tempo for me. I can, if you listen to what I do now, I always try and bring something that I used to listen to into my music. I don't stick onto like I don't stick making wobblers or bassline tunes or whatever. I try and involve everything that I listen to. Like, I even try and make like dubstep sounds a bit trancy, because like, I listen to it. Never really had any preference to music when I was young either. I think that helped me with my music now. I don't know what I come across as, but you can catch me listening to like hip hop. You can catch me listening to rock. Not even like the trendy indie style stuff. Catch me listening to any stuff, even heavy metal. It could just be, hit me with something. It could be anything. It's just how well it's produced and if I can hear the time into it and stuff, it interests me. Shall I tell you what it is? It's the dub plate culture. Because people want to hear tunes that they can't get, the only next thing to do is to get me out of it, sort of thing. So it works for me to keep my tunes to myself, and tunes get released a bit later, but it's always good because keeps people hungry and they get into the scene, and the first thing that people do, they get into the scene and they say, where can I buy this record? And as soon as it could be 2 weeks after I've told them, oh, I'm the only one with it, they're already getting into requests to how to get me out of this sort of thing. And they might not have even done a rave in their life, but they think, oh, I've got to hear it again, oh. And that's it, I'm out of it, sort of thing. It's mad. Before, it was kind of letting it off quite loosely. But since I've been away so much and I can't write as much as I did, because I used to write 10 tracks a week, mad quick. But then now, it's because I'm away, I'm like, I try to keep a little circle, so I'd give it out to Hatcha, Tubby and N-Type and Scream. But then I'll have another circle, which will be ab names that I'm not going to say, but they kind of get like a month later. And then, yeah. Don't kill me. Right, I was just gonna load up a song and show you what I've got, but I'm using, my speakers are Dyne Audios, BM6As. I'm on a PC, I run a Logic. I still run on loops to get my drums, like Fruity Loops, my little lingo, loops and FL and all that. I still run that for drums, kicks and snares. That's about it really. I've got a keyboard, I've got a sub for bass. I want to hear what it would sound like at the club. I've got a little desk, and that's about it, really. I've got a microphone, a booth, a little mini one, which I think that taught me a lot about mixing down. Before I had the microphone, it's little things I didn't understand about recording, which helped me in my whole Logic game. But then, that's about it. I'm a VST man. I would show you my list, but I know some of you out there will get them, start copying. Keep that under wraps. I'm more of a software man though. I have used hardware in certain projects that I've worked on, but it's more, I can't see the point of using hardware now with the software that's about. The only samples I have are drums, and I still have, like when I do a remix, I keep the parts like the acapella and stuff, and I chop them up, people are like, no, I'm still using them and that, but that's about it. I don't really sample from vinyl anymore. I thought about getting into sampling from my Skybox again, because when we made Judgment, parts of from Judgment, I sampled from my box, I can't remember what I was running then, but I just thought it would be nice to get back into that vibe again, because all then it was all samples, no sounds. I didn't really have many VSTs. Even my bass lines were sampled. Me and Skream played at a festival in Budapest maybe a month ago. And just the vibes, everything, but then it's different because it was a festival. But even Australia was good. But it hasn't been anywhere where I couldn't say I wouldn't want to go back again. Or don't follow me, kids, but I always eat McDonald's, so I couldn't tell you anything about cultures except, like, I don't know. Where I go places, I try out their chocolate. That's about the only thing I try out. And you get some weird chocolate. Like different things you'll never get in England, but I couldn't really tell you a lot because I'm more than McDonald's and KFC. Yeah. I said earlier that people could hear my tunes and say, where can I get that tune? And I'd say, I'm the only one that's playing it. Where did they hear it? On the internet. That's how it all starts. Then they get that, and I get that booking, so. Internet has been, I would say it's like 70% of how the dubstep has grown internationally, if not more. It's crazy, isn't it? www.myspace.com/Benga Beats. Obviously my album, which is Diaries of an Afro Warrior, it was more because I was writing so many tunes, like dancefloor tunes, and I was getting approaches from everywhere. Just wouldn't believe it for certain tunes and stuff. It just made sense for me to start compiling it and start working towards something rather than just having loads of stray releases and stuff. And for me, it was like, there was no other labels except from Big Apple and Tempo, which I, sounds rude for me to say, but I had enough respect for to release an album on. So, that's how it came about. Sarah approached me. Even before she approached me, I was thinking about it, so it was bang, it's ready to go. The CD is more about chilled out stuff that you can listen to at home. Well, even not even chilled out, but just home listening. The vinyl is all dance floor. We've aimed for, like, the vinyls, obviously, the DJs are gonna pick up. People that don't listen to stuff that will pick up CD. So we've made it quite broad. The original release date was October the 8th, but it's been delayed. It's January. Big up Tempo, because that's the label it's coming out on. I think if she never came to me and approached me to do the album for them, I wouldn't have ripped what I ripped then. Because even then, if you listen to my Big Apple EP, the Tempo EP, all of the songs are just bassline wobblers sort of thing. But then I think when I went to make the album, I created more music and stuff, which is always what you're going to do when you make an album. So it made me take a step back. But now I'm back to my bass lines. My aim is to do 5 albums for Tempo. And I reckon, I don't want to do an album 1 month and then 3 months later do another one. But this one was like the quick one. but it gives me time for my next one to sit down and just experience. And I think it's more every time I do an album, I experience something. And that point where I have in my life, where my music comes out, so I don't know. Hopefully we sit here and we do another DVD. I'm telling you about my second album. My hair, yeah? Yeah, it's more, from when I was even young, it was a thing like, people only grew their hair when they couldn't afford a haircut. But I've never liked that. I just liked my hair in mad state, that's bush sort of thing that people say to me, why don't you cut your hair? Oh, this bush, do you think that looks good? But I'm thinking, I like it. Do you think I care if you like it? It's more my sort of thing, like what I mean, like how I come across as a person. Like, if you don't like it, what? Why does it bother me? About killing two in the CD DJs, it's all about dub play. Like, more the way they sound, the vibe it all creates, like just bringing out your dub, everyone looking at you, like bringing it out and thinking, that's a song that we can't get. Don't know. We'll see the sound of it. But yeah, I'll say dub plates all day long over CDs. How that come about is me and Koki, like we made two songs before that. There was like, one of them went on New Step, which was World War 7. And the other one, we didn't really do a lot with, but I always thought working with him, we're gonna come out with something mad. I just knew it. I just, like, the way we both think about making music is so different. Like, so it's kind of like, fight to make something come out. It's mad. But then we sat here and we could have come up with like a wobble or a bassline track, but we thought we didn't come together to do that. We could do that separately. So we experimented and we come up with that, the mad little hook, and everything else just fell into place. I think with the both of us, the way we write, we have an idea in our head before we sort of sit down and play anything. So as soon as that hook came up, everything else is already there. And the tune is Koki Night. I'm saying that now. I can't believe I'm saying that. The tune's made by me and Koki, which I'm Benga and Koki, and the tune's called Night. It's always good to see a song from the genre that I'm writing in go like that sort of thing, because I've written a lot of other songs before that, like, I'm not going to say what I've written, and they've been playing them like in commercial clubs and gone places. But Skream was telling me in Tokyo he went off and he zinc played it. It's mad. And how can you play it from a 170 BPM to a 140 and the tune, yeah, rewind, start, playing the tune from the top and it's still working? I'd expect everyone to be like, oh, this is really slow, can't move to it, I'm stiff, see it. But I don't know, something weird about that song. I'm Benga and you're watching Dubfiles.
Yeah, yeah, yeah! This is Search and Destroy, I'm Pryor.
I'm Loan and you're watching Dubfiles. Well, basically the name Search and Destroy comes from, well, I kind of come up with it. Wanted to try and find like something that could have a double kind of meaning. And that's a bit, it's a bit dark, but everyone's asked us who's searching, who's destroying. Destroy. It's not really like that. I'm Lion, it's Prior, and we're going to get a third person in a script, everyone said, you know what I mean? But yeah, basically it's just, I don't know, man, it kind of sums up the
harder, way.
Darker kind of sound that we bring, kind of thing, do you know what I mean?
So, yeah, and what each other brings to it in a way.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. And this whole who is search, who is destroy, I don't know, it's a funny thing.
Now you know.
Neither of us.
We was both working at a music store in London.
We're not going to name.
We're not going to name, because they're giving no free promotion, because we don't like them.
Yeah.
But I was making like dark garage, and Joe was making drum and bass.
Making drum and bass and a lot of experimental, like weird stuff, like IDM, whatever you want to call it, just weird twitchy beats and stuff like that, man. And yeah, man, I think Paul showed me quite a few garagey bits. At first I was quite reluctant to get into it because I wasn't really into the garage. I was quite narrow-minded, really, just to be honest with you. But yeah, it showed me a few things like from Zed and Oris. And when I heard a few Oris bits, I was like, yeah, okay.
I was just playing stuff down in the shop we worked in, and I was chatting to D-Bridge from Bad Company,
And he said, oh, there's a whole night that plays this kind of music. And I didn't even know at the time, we didn't even know that anyone was even making this music. Like, I heard a few ghost bits, but we went down to Forward and checked Taurus J and J the Flex back to back, and that was it, really.
It was a birthday bash when
Miss Dynamite was down there.
Zeppelin's down there as well, yeah.
Dubplate.net was a big thing as well. Like, we met a lot of people, like, who we didn't even know what they looked like, but shared the same interest, and you go, oh, I'll link you down Forward. And like, we just meet Plastic Man at the bar for the first time. Oh, you're like Plastic Man from the forum. At the time, we was just like people making beats. Like, no one was anything at the time. And we just all made really good friends and played each other's beats down Forward, and that's how it kind of started, really.
What was quite funny was Paul was showing me, yeah, there's these guys that make this kind of dubstep music, and he showed me the website, and it's like, sure, mom, I was like, wait, I know this lot, grew up with Bandit, you know what I mean? So it's like, oh my god, man. So when you hooked up with them, it's like, kind of, I don't know, man, sealed it a bit more, do you know what I mean? Got a bit more into it from when onwards, man. Musical influences, well, I don't know, man. I was heavily into drum and bass back in the day, making it for about, I don't know, so 8 to 10 years. On and off kind of thing, you know what I mean? But it was the drums and just, I don't know, the kind of, just the vibe that got me into it. I got out of it kind of like 1999, 2000, because it just got a bit too, I don't know, man, everything became about who's got the loudest sound, who's the darkest or whatever. I was originally into like the Photic type sound, minimal drums, intricate, but sparse drums, heavy bass. I draw from that. Also, I draw from a lot of funk, mainly funk, old kind of 60s, 70s soul music and stuff like that, man. And that, for me, is probably at the moment my main kind of influence, man, amongst others, a bit hip hop and all that, but yeah, funk, I have to put as my, definitely my main influence.
I was massively like influenced by like early hardcore and rave, like from such a young age. Like, I remember the first time like I come across like pirate radio was by accident. Like, I was probably 8 or 9, like in my mum's car, so you're going shopping and I like hit the blow pump, you know, had them big buttons, and it just randomly hit some pirate. And I was like, whoa, this is amazing. Like, and while other, like from 9, like while the other kids were like watching Bros on Top of the Pops or something like that, I was upstairs tuning into my pirate, like Sunrise FM or something like that. And then it went on, you know, to Jungle, and Cool FM, and then it moved on to like listening to DJs like Andy C, like who was like, a massive influence for me, like DJ wise, production wise. Even from when he was on the Pirates beforehand, like he was just like playing. If I had them tunes he had, I'd be playing them, do you know what I mean? And the sounds that they was making, like Ram Records, were making the three of them, like Shimon and Miles, people like that. I just thought these sounds like are amazing. Like, I've never heard sounds like it anywhere. I want to make tunes, I want to make sounds like that, and that got me like wanting to make tunes, really. Like, our styles like are very, put us alone like and tell us to make tunes and they'll just be completely different. We like, our styles musically are very dissimilar to each other,
which is a good thing,
but yeah, like when we get together in the studio, which is like kind of rare, like, but how we kind of started working now is sending audio to each other where we can't always fit in, but yeah. I've kind of gone off on one, going back to it, we're like, Jay's really good at drum programming, I'm kind of more into making sounds. Jay's kind of got a kind of a raw sound to him, whereas I've got like a more techie sound. But when we meet into like together, there's more of like a kind of search and destroy sound.
Yeah. Meeting so, in the middle, it's the meeting in the middle that actually does.
And
it.
Also where we're so different, like every time we make a tune together, it always sounds different to what probably we'd expect it to sound, do you know what I mean? If you're just making tunes on your own all the time. So I think, yeah, it works well, really.
Try and be a little bit diverse as well, rather than just make like one style. I mean, a lot of people kind of know us for like the harder kind of styles, but we don't, just do that. I don't know why most people think that, to be honest with you, but I've done like more mellow kind of stuff, like stuff we're working on at the moment. It's a little more musical, I don't know, it's deeper kind of vibe, you know?
Really,
but a lot of those tracks don't get as much kind of recognition. People don't really hear them, really, so they don't know what to do about that. But everything, really, man.
Major pressure. I don't know what you'd say, but I'd say, like, even from before Food Chain, even if, like, you're releasing tunes and you've got people, like, who are following what you're doing, it's very hard to like, keep everyone happy with your tunes. But not just keep them happy, but keep yourself happy. To come up with a follow-up, like to come up with a follow-up's hard because inspiration only comes so often and you can't force it, do you know what I mean? And it's kind of been like a bit tough for the last year where I haven't like really been able to get in a studio together with Jay.
Yeah, it's been quite hard, man.
Responsibilities and that, but we're back on it now and like, to be honest, I'm more excited than ever now. Like the music that's coming through there. Loads of stuff popping up now.
So back to that point. Yes or no, to be honest with you, because the thing is, like, once you want to make a certain tune of a certain type, people jump on that and they're accepting more like that. So yeah, obviously you try and, if one particular tune does well, you're going to try and do more like that. But it's a double-edged sword because, like I was saying earlier about trying to do different kind of things. If you're trying to, there was a point where we just did that kind of style for a short period and it just got very stagnant, to be honest with you, so we just started doing other stuff, man. But it's kind of what we're known for, like I said to you earlier, the harder kind of raw edged kind of stuff. So still doing quite a lot of that, but regards to pressure, yes and no.
Yeah, I think the pressure's kind of gone now, like where we kind of had a little break, like not a break as such, but not really put our stuff out there for a little while, and the kind of pressure's off now and we're just like squirrels gathering their nuts, ready for the harvest. I think it's all a clock. I think everyone has their moment in time. And like, for a certain time, we had that, like, and styles change, and there's always flavour of the month and that. And I think at the point we're at now, where we've got tunes together, we've kind of come up with a new sound, and I'm more happy with it because it kind of meets in the middle of everything, like musically, like the whole patterns of the tune, everything, like, and I think it's coming, like it's coming round, and I think we're at the right time for it.
Yeah, it's more dance floor, plus it's musical to listen to as well, do you know what I mean? Rather than just have a tune that you can only play on the system, it's something you can actually listen to in your headphones as well, which I mean, that's quite important to us as well, to have some kind of musical element to it that makes it music, do you know what I mean?
Or just someone could sit down and listen to it and go, like, with certain other producers I do, like, I'll just, like, some of the dubstep, like Toasty Boy, for instance, I can drive around and listen to some of his tunes and forget where I'm driving. Like that deep tunes that you can dance, tunes that you can just listen to at home as well. That's what we're kind of getting more into as well.
That's the ethos of the moment. Music. To be honest with you, originally 5 to 5.5 years ago when I first got into dubstep, which was called dubstep back then, there was no boundaries to the music. It was kind of freeform. You could do whatever you want with it, do you know what I mean? It was just music. And if you went to Ford, you'd hear everything all night, do you know what I mean? Not just like garagey stuff, breaky stuff, everything, you know what I mean? Grime, whatever. It's only lately that
you're hearing one.
The dubstep stuff has kind of been molded into one kind of strain of music. So if anyone's kind of around it, they kind of don't fit into it. I don't know, it's kind of weird, man. It is bizarre, but
we're just like, I don't say, oh no, I'm not having it. We are dubstep, like, because some people, like someone said to me a few days ago, somebody said to me, yeah, but you're not dubstep, are you? And that's someone like I was talking to, like, and they've been listening to the music for a year. But like at the beginning when we all started getting together, like Ford was a place where you'd hear zinc tunes, like some people call that break step. you did a Plastic Man tune that would be like grime.
Yeah.
Grimy electro, like, and then you'd hear Zed Bias.
Swan kind of.
Some people would now call it broken beat, like, but it was all, that was like, really, it weren't called dubstep then. It was called forward. Like, forward was like, forward music. And now it's dubstep. And forward everyone thinks, that it's got to be dubby.
It's weird because there's this, like, mold that's developed to the music. I don't know how or why, but it's like, if it doesn't adhere to that kind of thing, it's not dubstep. I mean, I'm not too bothered about being classed as dubstep.
Yeah, we're just like search and destroy at the end of the day.
Whatever, man, it's no biggie, you know what I mean? The thing is, like, a lot of the new cats coming in nowadays, all the new guys are kind of like, they don't know that they're supposed to be making tunes like this. So a lot of the new guys coming in are just doing stuff that's like completely different, you know what I mean? It's quite interesting, the amount of new people coming in and the way the music's going now.
There's some really good talent
coming around, man, and it's good times ahead, trust me.
First release was...
Yeah, it was Fragile Beats, and you've got to big up Loms, mate.
Yeah, to Lombardo.
About any doubt, big up Loms. Basically all started from us meeting Jada Flex, because we was playing a few tunes downstairs at the music shop. And we sent him a CD and he got back to us. It had a few tunes on it, one of them being Bandero. And Jada Flex got back to us and he said he really liked it. So, and he was going to give it a play on his show. He played it on Hot Off The Press and
got reloaded.
Yeah,
thing as well, which is cool.
Yeah, and people started asking for it down forward and they started getting airplay down forward. And then we used to go down there armed up with CDs and just give them to anyone who'd take them, really. And kind of went from there, I suppose. Lombardo got in touch with Oris because he'd heard the tune. Because he didn't have our number and he gave us a call and said, I'd like to put your tune out. And we was more than happy to put that out of him. A second release.
Next was Candy Floss.
Yeah.
Paul from Hot Flush got hold of us. Basically had a little drink with him and Sid down in the pub down my local.
Yeah.
Down around the corner for me. So I had a chat with him. He seemed pretty on the ball. Really had a passion for the music and all that. So we said, yeah, man, went with it. Gave him a B-side and ended up putting out, which was nice. It was quite a different vibe as well for back then. Like you said earlier, like it was kind of like a ladies' tune, and I think that the difference of it, like the musicality of it, was what kind of got it where it was, kind of thing. You know what I mean? Because it was a whole different vibe.
There's nothing especially, really with the rose as well, you know? And bass and vocals in, I suppose.
And it still isn't, which is a bad thing.
It was always something that we wanted to do, was have our own label. Oris always said, get established on other people's, more established labels, which I would say, yeah, definitely, looking back on it, we did the right thing. Destructive, really, for me, was just pushing artists and our sound, really, that's what the whole our sound thing came from.
Yeah, the first release was our sound.
There was labels putting out stuff, but there was there wasn't the sound that I was looking for. And what better way to put other people's sound out your feeling and create a whole kind of camp than to set up your own label. So Destructive started with our sound, which was a group of friends and like-minded producers.
Yeah.
Just come together and I was like, that was it. This is our sound, this is what we're doing. Have a listen and let you know what you think. And it did really well for the time. We're Search and Destroy, yeah, and you're watching Dubfiles.
Trust My Logic, which was the first tune I ever made, and EZ played it and I was over the moon, and then that was it, really. And then I made Nomad.
Yeah.
I met people at Forwards, and then they were starting a label, and then they wanted this tune, and then it all just spiraled went from there. And I think it was about a year after that, I saw like Doug's and like G down at Forward, and Doug, I'd already been calling Doug's, like hassling him to see if there's any sets going on Rinse.
Yeah.
And he just went, look, you know, we really like this Forward thing. Send us another demo and then we'll see what happens. And then within like I think 2 weeks he said, yeah, you're on, like we'll text you a time. And then and that was it really. I used Cubase version 5 for the last 4 years, and that was what, that's probably about 10 years old or something. Before it was called Dubstep, or before everyone was calling it Dubstep, it was kind of a bit more like this. Do you know what I mean? There was like so many sounds which are kind of fitting into it more. But I think now it's kind of gone a bit more narrow. But in a way that's kind of bad, but in a way it's good because it's defining a scene, which is just bound to happen, I suppose, as it becomes. Yeah, yeah, it's bound to get smaller and just more defined. But I think there's a lot of people that are now being interested and they're kind of hearing what's going on now rather than what was going on when we all started doing it. So the tunes and the styles that everyone seemed to be that interested in are the ones obviously that are just happening kind of now. I think it's like healthy. There's loads of like new producers, you know, kind of sending me tunes and that. I think it's just, like I said, it's just finding people that come with something that little bit different. So I'm just I'm so fussy with my own tunes. Like I start tunes and just scrap them so quickly. If I think it sounds, I don't know, if I listen to it, I think, oh, I don't know, that just reminds me slightly of this, I'll just stop straight away. And I'm kind of the same, if someone gives me a tune, I'll just listen to it, I'm like, yeah, but I don't know, that reminds me of this. And if it does that, no, it's just something wrong with me, I just can't touch it. I'm just like, no, I can't play that tune. I mean, I'll listen to it and appreciate it, but if it's in me DJing, I just won't play it. I mean, I think the way it's spread like internationally so quickly is amazing. Because like what last year, like, the only places I played really were London and Bristol, and oh yeah, Bristol and Leeds, London. Yeah. And like this year, I've been kind of out of nowhere. Do you know what I mean? Like it literally came to January, and in that first month, I think I got a booking for Belgium, Poland, Croatia, and talks to do in Finland, which never happened. But then like the last couple of weeks, like last weekend, no, the weekend before I was in Austria, the weekend before I was in Amsterdam, and then a month before that I was in San Francisco and Los Angeles. I wouldn't say it's obviously as big as it is here, but I think a lot of the shows I'd done, like the one I did in Croatia, the one I did in Los Angeles, were the first ever dubstep nights ever, you know. But afterwards they all kind of start like listening, like, yeah, what's going on. But by the end of the night they're all just going mad. Like even when you wheel a tune, do you know what I mean, they're just like absolutely, like the first time I wheeled a tune, I think a Pinch was playing in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And he played like this new Skream tune, and I like darted through everyone, all like looking at me, what's going on, I think I've got a bomb or something. And then I just bang, you know, stop the tune, they all look at, like, in disgust, like what's he just done, like that. But then I feel like two people who kind of knew about the dubstep thing just all started cheering, and everyone was just like, ugh. And then from then on, the whole night was just mental. My sets always kind of start from a bit more mellow, working their way up slowly. But saying that, like the more I've played out recently, or should I say like this year, it has kind of been different each time. Like, because there's times when, like for example, when I was in like America, like I said, like Pinch was on before me playing certain tunes or whatever. And I thought, right, I could either come on and just go back and play something mellow, or I can just drop something that I know everyone's just going to go mental to. So that's what I'll do. Sometimes I'll just come on and just play like the most ridiculous tune I can, just so that everyone's just like, wow, you know, it's like it's just stepped up again kind of thing.
Yeah.
Or, I don't know, just play something completely different than even dubstep, which like some people do. Probably the biggest thing, like if everyone actually thinks about it, is the internet. That's like the biggest reason ever. I mean, out of nowhere, people were recording everybody's sets on Rinse, like everybody. Like, I could do my set, come home, and it's on the net to download, and I'm like, ah, oh, you know. And I think from there, just people, you know, it's obviously just spread and spread and spread. I mean, the mixes just end up on the most random like blogs, like, you know, just some guy called Jeff who fixes cars. He's like, oh yeah, but I was listening to this mix. Do you know what I mean? And then out of nowhere, you've got these people listening to his music, they're like, what's this? You know, where'd it come from? And I think that's why. But also, I think it's just accessible in a way. I suppose in a way it's not because of the tempo. I think everyone thinks of dance music and thinks that they have to be going absolutely mental and just sweating and just, I don't know, just yeah, peeled up and just going absolutely nuts. Whereas dubstep, it's kind of like you don't have to do that. It's kind of a weird thing to explain, but if it's like having to, it's like going to a nightclub, but it don't mean you have to dance. You see what I mean? You can go to this nightclub, you can drink, you can chat, and you can just enjoy the music, or you can be that crew of people in front of the decks just going absolutely nuts. And I know there's people like at DMZ and at Forward who do, that's all they do, they just sit there in the corner drinking, just enjoying the music, and that's it. And it's just like, why can't you do that? Do you know what I mean? And that's like any big rave as well, I guarantee there's about 100 people just standing there, just enjoying themselves, listening to the music. And they won't be there for an hour, they'll be there for like four, you know. Yeah. But there is the whole element of the people jumping up, going crazy. And I think the whole thing with like rewinds, even though it's saying like they're a negative thing, but in a way it gives them, I think the people just want to be involved. Like they see someone reach up and stop the tune and they want to be the person who's like there going, yeah, you know, pressing the button or whatever. In a way, if you were to just, I don't know, look like you're going to slap them if they do it, you're going to kind of ruin their night. Well, the thing with me is I was never really into drum and bass. Like people say this stuff to me, they're like, oh, you know, I was so into drum and bass and out of nowhere, they all sold out and done this and whatever. And I'm like, oh, I don't really know what you're talking about. Do you know what I mean? It's like, I liked certain tunes, but to me, those certain tunes existed and I bought them. I didn't know what else was going on or what they did before or what they're doing now that everyone don't like. I just like that tune. And that's how I bought my tunes out of drum and bass. Whereas, I don't know, I suppose if people have been following it from jungle to progression, then I suppose they can see where everyone started. I mean, what someone said to me, actually when I was in Austria a couple of weeks ago, he was saying that why he liked dubstep so much is because it just seems like people just making tunes for themselves, not necessarily for the dance floor. And he said like his heroes in jungle, this is exactly what they did. Like as soon as they saw certain tunes tear up on the dance floor or whatever, that's all they cared about. And he said before you know it, every single tune is a jump up tune and they just lost interest, you know. That's probably the biggest underground music that is still underground. Do you see what I mean? I mean, like house and everything, yeah, but you're guaranteed there's going to be some of them tunes in the charts, do you know what I mean? Like every other month or whatever, whereas drum and bass, you might get one a year, if that. I don't think that's been one, is there, for ages that's got into the charts. But, I don't know. I think people, yeah, I think that's probably why people compare it. Because of that, and because obviously there's similar sounds, like it's bass heavy, a lot of kind of dub and ragga samples and that. Like I said, you've got big names, you know, like kind of like Skream, and you've got like Cokie, and I think people that are new to the thing, they're probably going to be the first names they hear, it's like Skream and Cokie, and they'll go and listen to the tunes and think, all right, this is dubstep. Do you know what I mean? And then maybe 3 months down the line, they'll hear, you know, like Toasty, or they'll hear, like, you know, Pinch, or they'll hear, like, yeah, well, yeah, or Distance, you know, do you know, and then maybe then they'll see what the whole deal is. But I think some people won't do that, that they may just think, oh, well, this is what dubstep is, you know. But that's always going to happen, though. As soon as something's big, everyone's going to try and jump on it. I think especially new people trying to get in. But I think that in a way they're the easiest people to spot, because they'll give you a tune that sounds identical to something else. And you're just like, well, it's obvious. You just like this, I don't know, that you're just trying to get into this somehow and you're just going to try and replicate a tune that's just massive at the moment. But I never see any point in doing that, because if you're trying to copy or if you're looking at someone else for your ideas, then you're never going to be ahead. Because the next time you go and see them, they're going to have another tune like, oh my god, where did that come from? And you're never ever going to do that. Do you want to be like a pioneer in it? If you want to be a pioneer, then you've got to stay ahead and just not be afraid to do what you want to do. But I think that's why dubstep in a way is fresh and will remain fresh, is that a lot of people think the same way. So I mean, like if you listen to people, like especially like, you know, like Mala and all of them people, like there's so many producers still that surprise me when I go and see them, and that's probably what's keeping me interested, you've got to think, before I was making tunes, before a lot of the people were making tunes, you were going to a place, you know, you're going to Forward, and who you're seeing Youngster, and you're seeing Hatcha.
Yeah.
And, like, and everyone who was making that music was going to them to play it, because no one was giving us the chance to play. So then they've built up their name by having all the fresh tunes, and to be honest, you know, this is a good, I mean, without them, you know, it probably wouldn't be where it is now anyway, so... But it's bound to be people, I mean, like N-Type, I mean, I know he produced a couple of tunes, but he's got a big name for himself, and he is more or less just DJ. A DJ at the moment. And I think it's just like his whole personality, really. I think it's just like his personality when he's on radio, and even when he's mixing and everything, it's just like energetic and a bit more creative maybe than some people. I mean, if I was an outsider, and I wasn't who I was, and I wasn't doing what I was, I'd blatantly be thinking, right, I'm just going to make a tune as popular as I can possibly, you know, just a tune that I hope everyone's going to like, just so I can become a DJ, and just so I can get loads of bookings, and that's that. In a way, that's kind of, not what I did, but I was thinking, right, I want to make a tune, you know, and hopefully that'll keep things rolling. But the thing was, is I made a tune and gave it out, and I didn't have any other tunes. You need to have, like, to be able to follow it up, yeah. I mean, luckily I was able to just make, like, I did Trust My Logic, and then that got, was getting played and everything, and then I just managed to bash out a few more tunes. So obviously it weren't like a fluke, so respect the people that are already within it. Like, I've had people come up to me just saying, I get like messages from people off AIM saying, yeah, send me some tunes. Do you know what I mean? Like, I don't even know who they are. They're not even asking me, they're telling me to send them tunes. And it's just like, I don't even bother replying to them. Or, yeah, just respect the people that are in it. Come along to the nights. Like, we're all approachable people. You can just chat to us. Do you know what I mean? I don't think I'm anybody. Do you know what I mean? It's just like, just come and chat to me. I don't really care who you are. And then it's the same with everybody. You can pretty much talk to anyone, and I'm sure, if you was to give them a disc, they'd go home and listen to it. I mean, it's hard getting responses from everybody. It's just difficult. I mean, you're getting tunes on AIM, you're getting sent tunes. To go through all of them and be able to reply to everyone ain't easy. But you just gotta, I don't know, don't be disheartened, I suppose. Just gotta keep doing it. As soon as there's one tune, you'll know about it, because everyone will be contacting you and saying they like it, so.
Do you know what I mean? 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 Do you know what I mean?
Cashmere, look, cashmere, a bit of silk tie.
Worth a bit, that is.
Yeah, got a bit of a shirt and some test presses as well. I'm a Dubs. Don't forget my Dubs. And some shoes to go with it. What else have we got in here? We've got some boxes. I've got my boxes. Look how crap them boxes are. Look at them. They're like 1940s boxes, mate.
Like the window, yeah. It blew off, like the whole thing, like the wood, the whole lot, the whole thing. It blew open because it don't shut properly.
Yeah.
And then when it was like really windy, like New Year, the whole thing blew off, and it's still in the next door neighbour's garden. You can still see it now, yeah?
Well, just cotching in there.
It's still that all smashed up and that old wooden frame, like, still right. Intact, like in her garden. That was in January, she hadn't said a thing, we never see her. My window is still in her garden, and my window still doesn't close. It's only a matter of time.